I have some order, please? Calling the meeting of the Conservation Commission to order, it being after 7 o'clock. And the first item on the agenda is a continued request for determination of applicability for 2016-6 420 West Street, map 20, lot 200, Salada. Ms. Salada? Right.
Right.
We had asked for the percentage of imperviousness of the pavers that you are proposing for your patio, and the location and the name, the Latin or scientific name of the species that you are planting in lieu of taking down the Norway spruce.
So this is the... And then we did some research on the pavers, and we checked the manufacturer's website, but we could not find anything that noted scale or percentage for the pavers other than what I gave you already.
Are you working with Jack Sullivan?
We are.
Did he have, did you ask him if...
I did.
And he had nothing
he
to add?
He had he provided. And we're going to use a permit with pavers, but the manufacturer's website didn't have anything more than what we provided. We looked through multiple documents. We just didn't see anything that has scale or percentage.
Madam Chair, can I comment for a second?
You can go.
I also went to the manufacturer's website in search of that information, because as good a spec as this is a installation spec, I think, and not necessarily a performance spec. You know, like, and if it's installed correctly, it has, and maintained correctly, it has the potential to infiltrate, you know, whatever it's designed to be able to infiltrate. That said, I did find on the website among its variety of permeable pavers, one claim, like, that one particular type of paver can infiltrate up to, and I know this sounds incredible, it did to me, can infiltrate up to 140 inches an hour. If the base is laid correctly, but that was
140 cubic inches.
Inches of rain.
No, that's that can't
it's
be right.
It's got to be a volume.
But that, I mean, that was the sentence, you know, at the top of the I found some other, other industry, not necessarily Unilock, that said could infiltrate up to 10 inches of rain per hour. So I don't think we have an exact infiltration infiltration rate for these permeable pavers right now, but for me, my opinion is the fact that, you know, we've got a spec on how it's supposed to be installed. So clearly, you know, there's some knowledge of doing, installing these pavers the appropriate way. For me, since they're designed permeable, that's sufficient for me in this example.
Jamie, do you have any rule of thumb that you seem to have had some experience with?
Well,
it wasn't 100%.
In aquifer protection, where it wasn't 100%. Well, in the aquifer protection district, our planning and town engineers consider it 0% permeable in their calculations.
That's an assumption, though. That's
They give no credit for pervious pavers.
Right. The manufacturers, I think, make other.
Manufacturers make other claims, and I have seen from certain manufacturers before this committee stated permeable rates. I can't remember them off the top of my head.
I was looking for them.
And they were, if I remember correctly, they were stated as a percentage of various soil types, sand, clay, something like that. I mean, they showed the comparison in permeable rate, so you could judge it accordingly, is what I remember seeing, but I can't put my hands on that.
I guess I'm saying for my own opinion in this matter, I'm satisfied with the detail presented.
I am too.
Yeah, I think the applicant presented it as impermeable in their calculations.
I don't think any claim was made.
Well, when they, correct me if I'm wrong, but when you showed us 2 weeks ago the percent impervious before and after your action, and in those calculations you showed that those permeable pavers were impervious. They were included in the impervious square feet.
No, they should be considered pervious because the square footage within your driveway, you know, replacing the walkways is less impervious than what exists today.
Right.
So the patio installation in the walkways would be permeable pavers.
And they were included in the, they were not included in the impervious calculations.
Correct.
Jim, that's what I recall as well.
Okay.
I believe we did do a just kind of a, off the back of the napkin calc to see what is, how does it compare, and we said, well, if we did add it, it was probably a wash.
Yeah.
Right? So.
Yeah, I'm fine with the application. I just am. I hate to set the precedent of calling these comparable to vegetated grass, for example. I also don't want to give, I hesitate to give no credit for installing pervious pavers because then there's no incentive for applicants to do that. That's my only concern. It's not specific to this application. It's just the precedent we set.
So, I would agree, Jamie. I think my, you know, one of the things I would say is, you know, I think if it, my experience is if installed properly, these things will drain pretty freely, but they have a design thing. You know, they eventually silt up, they eventually fill up.
Right.
And at that point, they are less, you know, don't have the same permeability. What that life is, I don't know.
Right.
It's a basic installation. So I agree with you in that sense, but that's...
Perhaps when our tree policy committee completes their work, we can form another pervious paver policy.
Maybe next year.
Committee.
We have enough committees. So,
yes.
So I...
The other item?
The other item, I think Chuck is satisfied.
Chuck, are you satisfied with the issues of dogwood?
I think it's fine. I'm going to cross-reference it back at my desk tomorrow, and we'll change it up if we have to.
Okay. All right. Okay. So you guys talk, right?
Yeah.
Were we looking for a native species?
Yes.
Yes.
I'm sure I make a motion to issue a negative determination of applicability.
Do I hear a second?
I'll second.
I second, but I still have a question. What are we specifying that they plant? You said you were going to check?
I need to. She just presented us with that.
Right. So I would I would issue that negative determination only with the confirmation that it's a native species.
It looks like you may want to change that. It looks like a cultivar.
And I don't see the Latin name here either.
Yeah, it is up on the left-hand corner.
Oh, okay. Right. Thank you.
Can I ask a question? What is a negative?
That means you're good.
Okay.
A negative determination on a request for determination of applicability means you don't have to file again under a different permit for a notice of intent.
Which you don't want to
have.
Okay. So for the tree, if there's something specific you're looking for, I'm happy to have you to.
Right.
Is it,
yeah.
Noted.
So
Chuck will work with you
okay.
on that.
Yeah.
So we'll talk to you more about
he has a list
okay.
of species that
okay.
are appropriate.
Oh, great. Okay.
Yeah. I heard a second. All those in favor? Those abstained?
Thank you
very much. Have a good night.
Thank you, Joe. We have a, next on the agenda is a continued notice of intent for Birch Meadow Park, a notice of intent 270-0656, and the public hearing, DEP 270-0656 is now reopened and being conducted concurrently under the authority of the Massachusetts Wetland Protection Act, Massachusetts General Law Chapter 131, Section 40 as amended, and the Reading General Bylaws, Section 4.7.1. The hearing will be conducted in the following manner. The applicant will present the work. The commission will receive additional reports from the administrator and other town departments. The commission will address questions, comments to the applicant. And the public will then be given an opportunity to ask questions of the applicant. And all of you who might want to talk about this, there is a sign-in sheet on that side of the room in the back. George Samoras?
Yes.
I'm sorry. I'd like to introduce the members of the Conservation Commission, starting on my left with Chuck.
Chuck Tarone, the Conservation Administrator.
Eric Curtis.
Michael Flynn.
Anika Scanlon, Vice Chair.
Rebecca Longley, Chair.
Al Couillard.
Jamie Mohan.
Amy Shipitani.
Judy Roger, Recording Secretary.
I was in attendance of the last one. Chris Cole was, well, by the point of the record, George Zimbor is down here. And I believe at the last meeting there were a few questions that we had to answer. A lot of them dealt with the lighting themselves. One, were they LEED certified? Another one, are they dark skies compliant? And the impacts to migratory birds, I believe, was probably what it boiled down to. This is a presentation that we got from Musco. It's one of their sales presentation, but there's some really good information in it that I'll go through. The one thing, LEED certification is actually for buildings. It's a measurement of the energy efficiency of a building, and they don't really apply to field lighting. As far as dark sky compliant, the type of fixtures that are used for sports lighting is what the industry calls amiable lighting. You aim the light to where you have to go on the field. And because of the nature of what they have to light, especially when it comes to softball and baseball, tennis and soccer are probably a little bit different, but because of the nature of the light, IDA, which regulates dark skies compliance, which Musco is one of their corporate partners and works closely with them to try to achieve their standards, IDA that will not certify any sports lighting as being dark sky compliant. and it's for a reason. What we have at the tennis courts are probably as close as you can come to a dark sky compliant fixture, and I'll show you the fixture later. It has full hood, it's almost fully shielded, and most of the light is directly downward and not upward. You achieve similar results in a softball, for a single softball, soccer field that we would be using for the synthetic field if the funds go that far. But when it comes to baseball, softball, the poles have to cut back from their traditional 12-inch shield and go to a 7-inch shield. And one of the reasons you can probably go, let me start here, and then I'll get back to it. These are all actually Musco lights. This is, you know, the fixture way to the left is what was typical in 1976. And what you have is, you know, through the years up until 2005, which is the light structure green lights, is what we're installing now. It's actually a modified version of that. It's more efficient than that one there. That's what the lights have evolved to through their designs and everything else.
So some of these fields are currently have lights on them.
Yes.
Second one, is it the second?
They're these. Those are those. Or a hybrid of that, because that's actually Musco's light, but typically they're all similar to something like that.
Yep.
And that's for Castine Field and men's softball field and the soccer field right now. So, the, getting back to the dark skies compliance, our light poles, I forget the exact heights, I think they're around, I think some are, they range between 40 and 50, 60 footers. I think it's 60 footers for the men's, the Morton Field. The balls, when they hit, go higher than that. So they have to, so what they do is they'll trim off the edge of the shield back from 12 inches to 7 inches. And you'll see in another slide, I don't want to go that far down. So you'll have about where my thumb is, that much more of the light that's exposed. So it does direct light up, so they can see the bottom of the ball. So because of that reason, and that's one of the reasons that no sports lighting that you could possibly illuminate for baseball or softball are dark skies compliant. Now, what we have done is we used the minimum standards for safety that are required for a softball and baseball at a high school level. Without delaying, softball field, we're using an average of 30-foot candles. When we get to the Little League field, which is outside the jurisdiction, we're using an infield 50-foot candles and 30-foot candles for the outfield. Morton Field, we're using 50-foot candles for the infield and 30-foot candles for the outfield. Basically the recommended MIA safety standards if you're going to light a field and play night games.
That's the illumination at the ground surface?
That's the illumination at the ground surface. When you get to college level, that 50 to 30 is, Musco said, semi-pro, it's 120 for the infield and like 80 or 90 for the outfield. When you get to major league, forget it, it's off the charts. Because they're up there and they're crazy. So it's we're doing the barest minimum possible. And as I said, Musco is probably one of the best, if not the best, in the industry. I mean, if you listen to them, they're the best, but any salesman will tell you that. But they are one of the best fixtures that are out there as far as getting the light where you want it, providing minimal fill, minimal glare, and at the best efficiency possible. I mean, these fixtures are guaranteed for 20 years. If one of the bulbs burns, we don't even pay a dime.
Are they LEDs or not?
They're not LEDs. LEDs, you'd actually need more poles.
Yeah.
And they're actually, LEDs are actually, because an LED cannot throw the light as far as these, you actually have higher foot candles at the base of the pole than what you would. Plus, one of the things that dark sky compliance and the issue with migratory birds were, I believe you mentioned it, are they blue light? LED is pure blue. It's one of the things that's very high in blue, so that's one of the things that would detract from it. These are slightly blue, but it's on the very low range of the blue, higher than incandescent, but in the low range.
So George, the new lights around town, are those the blue lights?
The new ones that RMLD is doing?
Yeah.
They're installing LEDs. I don't know what the color range is, but they're probably they're going
to
be a lot bluer than most of the LEDs. And I don't know if the chat's in the slide or not. Let me go back to this one. They don't have the slide. Like I said, the very last slide in the light is the 2005 version. What we're installing is the improved version of that. Now, the new improved version, over that 2005 fixture, there's 50% reduction in spill and glare. and 50% reduction in energy use. That's just in a 10-year period. Obviously, you know, I mean, I think I've mentioned that these are all remotely controlled. It's something whether we can, we don't have to turn the lights on and leave them on forever. These are going to be pre-programmed to come on when a game's on. And right now, the rec department, which they're going to have to review their rules and see what they're going to do with them. But as of right now, no inning can start after 10 o'clock. No new inning. I don't know if they're going to keep these same rules, but it's probably going to be something similar to that. So what will that mean? You know, if an inning doesn't start at 10, now it's going to have to experiment of how long an inning's going to last. Will it last a half hour? Will it last 45 minutes? Plus, you need the lights on long enough for people to leave. So right now, what I'm thinking is that, and I'm gauging this by Harry Ball Field in Beverly, that's a little league field that they did install lights on. I didn't do it, it was after I left. The lights are typically on about 45 minutes after. It seems, I shouldn't even say that, about 20 minutes to a half hour after people are stopped leaving. So assuming an inning starts at 10, as long as it's not an abnormally long inning, right now, the best guess is that the lights are going to be off somewhere between 10:45 and 11 o'clock. And they're only going to be on, based on current rules, I don't know if they're going to change. And they're only going to be on when there's a game. This is the difference for what's out there right now, the 1976. The green is basically supposed to represent the field you're trying to light. And the yellow is the illumination that the fixtures are putting out, and what percent of that illumination is actually hitting the field. Back in 76, it was 25%. In 2005, they're at 70%. They're even improved over that. I don't remember what the number was right now for the current lights, but I tell you. This is a fixture that is, it has a hood, but it's looking straight on it. That's not the one that's being installed. That's what's at the tennis courts.
Mm-hmm. Is that what is being proposed?
That will be on the soccer field.
Field, George, you mean that synthetic field?
Synthetic field.
I call it the lacrosse field, but.
Yeah, I don't know if I think I have this one sideways. I guess I don't.
One next parking lot,
but
not the track.
So this is the full
right.
12-inch. This is the full, I think if it's 10 or 12-inch shield. This slide here, which is the best picture he had, that's the 7-inch shield. And this is where I say that the end of the hood's cut out a little bit so you can get more light coming up to see the balls that are being up in the above the level of the light head itself. You're not interested in these control panels. I couldn't tell you where this is, but this was just a picture of showing you what spill and glare is.
Mm.
This is a light that has, I believe it was 2005, it wasn't 2005 lights, it was something halfway between the 1976 and the 2005 lights. Pay attention to this light here. That's what the light looks like with the fixtures that we're putting on right now. That's how much they've improved the spilling glare coming out of the fixtures. So that is basically what is going to get installed in that field. That's just showing one where, you know, to show that how that, you know, if you look, you have the baseball field and you're, you know, once you get a little bit behind the backstop, there's virtually no light, and the photometric plane that they showed indicated that too. I mean, once you're outside the dugout, you're below, probably 5 feet below the dugout, you're below 1 foot candle. Chuck, can you hit the one that was labeled in presentation two, I think it is?
Madam Chair, just for my feedback, I'm satisfied that the new lighting design is going to be an improvement over previous lighting, and going to sort of thread that thin line between what's needed in the area and providing additional protection from upward scatter, so.
This.
Chuck, did we ever get anything about the illumination? We had it horizontal. Did we ever get the vertical?
No, we didn't.
This is something I want to show you about that. This picture here, the one on the right is 2005. You didn't have numbers on what the 2015 lights are. And if you look at the old one, it's 3.9-foot candles, and the one all the way to the right is 0.29-foot candles. What that represents is standing 150 feet away from the fixture and pointing a light meter directly at the fixture. That's what you're seeing. That's what the light meter sees for foot candles. That's straight into the eyeball. So, I mean, it's going up, it's less than that. I can go on a little bit more about Boston, what they, what the reports
okay.
they did or whatever.
Chuck,
but
do you have any questions?
I don't.
Eric?
So, my two questions are really simple. So, the first question I had is, Musco controls all this.
They don't control it.
But
they don't.
But they have the.
They monitor it for us. We can either pre-program in the timing.
Yeah.
I got that.
I'm not trying to make this hard for you. So, the question I had is, at the end of the season,
mm-hmm.
are they going to be able to tell you when they're on and off, so you can see like a histogram of when they were on, and actually compare that year to year?
I think so. I'm not 100% sure, but I think we can pull that data off.
I think
if John was here, I'd know that right now, because we could have probably, actually, if he asked me the question, I could have logged on and looked at the Bancroft app lights. And find out, but I think that's a possibility.
I wouldn't even make that.
I'm not 100% sure.
I think that would be really good information for you guys to have over time.
So Harry, you're saying basically a real time schedule.
What I don't know is if they could tell us exactly. I mean, I imagine they do, because if we can program these lights of when to come on for up to like 5 years. So I'm sure they can pull that data out of the computerized system. Plus, I'm almost positive they can. They may not setting that calendar aside. I'm positive that they could tell us the number of hours the lights were on, but they may not be able to tell specifically what day or how long each day.
I'm thinking if you could see that, you know, every third Thursday they were on until midnight.
Mm-hmm.
So maybe next year you use that when you're scheduling. That's all I'm saying.
Well, that's something that John, you know, that the recreation and John's going to have to do. Like I said, they're going to have to adopt new regulations of, you know, really how long, you know, when they want these lights to shut off based on the last inning and everything. And, you know, they're going to have to get some feel on how long that last inning lasted.
I think that's fine. The other question, I'm sorry, really quick, is so behind, I think it's Morton Field, the lawn, the stream,
mm-hmm.
there's a.
On the third base side?
There's a fabric on the fence, I think. Like a dark
yes.
green.
There
mm-hmm.
is.
You mean in the outfield?
Yeah.
No, between third base and home plate.
I don't think there's a fence there.
I don't think there's a fence there. There's a fence on the outfield.
I thought there was something, because like when I went to look at the pole that was closest to the water there, there were two fences. Were you going to put
the. That's the outfield.
That mm-hmm. is the outfield?
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
That's the outfield.
No.
So
it's a chain link with.
It's a chain link with the padding on top of it.
There is silt.
Plus there is silt. There is silt. That's what I was going to say. There's silt fence still up there from when they were working on the dugouts that was permanent last year.
So there's a section that's good, at least 6 feet high of fabric.
Mm-hmm.
Just make sure that stays, and that actually helps with any light spill into the river, which is the most sensitive.
I don't think that's good.
Just an additional buffer.
Do you think that was in the third base side?
Yeah. That's it. Thank you.
Jamin?
So, George, are the lights manually turned off when after the game, when everybody's gone?
It's automatic.
It's programmed.
It's pre-timed.
But we don't know what time the game is going to end, so how
well,
can it
that,
be pre-timed?
And I say that's something that recreation is going to have to, trial and error, because John does not give control of the lights to the leagues. The recreation department controls the leagues. Matter of fact, you know, like the Bancroft tennis courts, I have a key, Ryan has a key, and John has a key, and we all have they're the only, we're the only three people in town that actually can turn those lights on and off.
So you folks are the ones that will be turning them on for the games that are scheduled?
It'll be, John will pre-program in the times for the, when the games are gonna be coming, and what days for them to come on, and when for them to shut off, and that's why I said that they're gonna have to, it's gonna be an experiment to find out, you know, what's that fine line? How close can I shut the lights off and still not make it totally dark for people as they're trying to leave the field?
Well, so, based on what you just said, we'll probably start turning the lights off about 10:45.
I would suspect that.
Let's say 10:45. But what if it's a fast game, or it gets canceled for rain at 8:00? Are those lights going to stay on from 8 till 10:45?
If it's canceled from 8:00, that's probably even before the lights actually would come on, so they would even.
Okay, 9:00.
The game was canceled.
9:00 then. But I think you see what I'm saying. Those lights going to stay on whether people are playing ball or not.
That's something that, you know, I don't know how John's going to work that out. I mean, you know, like he'll try. I know he wants to try to get them off in cases like that. Obviously, he doesn't want a phone call every night and say, okay, turn the lights off. So, you know, there's probably going to have to be someone else that can control these, but I know he doesn't want to give it to the leagues. It's going to have to be someone from town hall.
Yeah, it would be nice maybe John could show us a light management plan once he has it set.
Is that a concern to this commission?
Well, what we don't want, though, we don't want the lights on any more than they have to be.
Right.
And obviously, I don't think he wants it either. It's just
right.
That
we,
as of
and
right
as
now,
as a taxpayer in Reading, I don't want them on.
As of right now,
so it's not the
it's
town.
Not better.
They talked about this in the first meeting that about it's not even the town that's doing it. It's the league, the leagues that are actually paying for.
Right. The leagues pay for. The leagues pay for the lights. We don't pay for them.
Right, but they pay a flat fee.
I don't know what John.
I think they do.
They may.
Comes in with the rental of the field.
And you know, like John had told me, is that, you know, this is something that the Rec Commission and the Recreation Department are all going to have to basically, you know, iron out new rules for these lights, these new lights that are going out.
I mean, now, for example, it's not unusual at all to drive by Castine Field and lights on, nobody's out there at all. I would
those,
like
those are on straight direct time.
Right.
There's no automatic control. Actually, Castine, we're going to be able to control with this project. Is we're going to. That's why we're pulling the overhead feeds off Castine off those first two poles.
Right.
And pulling them into the control panel. So we're not going to have the automatic efficiency that tells us, okay, this bulb's burning out. But we'll be able to actually turn the lights on. John will actually be able to turn the lights on and off remotely to Castine.
Chuck, do you have any questions?
I don't have any questions, but I know that it was the question that we needed to tackle was the very mighty
communication.
Question.
You had taken some pictures of two areas?
Yeah.
That's fine if that's what you want us to do.
Take it that Phragmites.
We'll kill them.
Good.
Are there any questions from the public? Yes, ma'am. Can you? State your name.
My name is Maria Salvatelli, 25 Ronald Avenue.
How are you?
Good, how you doing, George?
Fine, nice.
Is there a way of accessing the lights remotely, or is it on site?
No, they can be accessed. John Feudo has an app on his phone that he can actually turn them on and off right from his phone, or any computer, anything that's tied to the internet, we can turn the lights on and off.
Any other questions from the public? Hearing none?
Well, just the question of having a report at the end of the first year of when they were on or not, is that something that we can, that the commission wants to ask for?
Whatever we can get off Moscow will supply.
I mean, it's not even for me, it's just a suggestion.
Yeah.
Because I think it'll help you, you know, next year.
Yeah,
you're looking at
how
to schedule the lights.
I think it's available. It's last time I was on this site is when we first started the bank process. I couldn't tell you what the options.
And the purpose of our reviewing that report would be to see how.
Yeah,
I
guess
to
sound like a nerdy aquatic biologist, we have that river going through there right next to Castine Field. We have those beautiful cattail marshes that George has helped us preserve around Castine Field. That is excellent aquatic habitat, including amphipods. And if we're blasting them with light more than we have to, it interferes with their fecundity. And we don't like to interfere with people's fecundity or amphibians' fecundity. So that's why the concern is. The birds are certainly a concern, but I think for the Wetland Commission, the aquatic biota is a concern also.
Duly noted. Do I hear a motion?
I have one question. We identified exactly what Chrysomites we want to have.
Chuck took some, went out and took some
photos.
There are two stands.
Yeah.
Along Birch Meadow.
Along Birch Meadow.
Okay, so that doesn't be included in the motion.
Well, it will be included in the order of conditions.
Conditions, yes.
We're not going anywhere. I may be, but we're not going anywhere.
I've noticed you've been more compatible to make commitments since you've announced your retirement, George. I move we issue order of conditions in line with the discussion tonight.
A second.
This may be my last meeting, so I appreciate working with everyone here. Appreciate your indulgence and
thank you, George.
And working with you for all
good
the
luck
years.
To you.
Thank you.
Thank all you, George.
Unless I file something before I leave.
All those in favor? Those abstain?
I would just like to say, George, it has been interesting and enjoyable working with you, and I was on the committee that selected George, and I don't think I made a mistake.
Thank you. Appreciate it.
Thanks, Chad.
Have a good night.
Thank you. Okay, next on the agenda. It says notice of intent, but it is a abbreviated notice of resource delineation. Low Meadow off of Arcadia Avenue, map 14, lot 15, Haskell. And we have the applicant's representative.
My name is Steve Merrickson from Norse Environmental Services. My understanding is several of the commissioners were out there, made some changes to some of the BVW boundary. We haven't had a chance to locate those yet, but we will do that and we can revise the plan. And my understanding is that some questions on the riverfront area. So let me concentrate on the riverfront area. Shown as perennial on the USGS, a more recent map provided by the department is perennial. The subject stream does not show on the USGS maps. Next slide says the river or stream shown as intermittent or not shown on the current maps. On more recent maps provided by the department, that a watershed size greater than or equal to 1 square mile is perennial. The latest current USGS map is the 1915, and I've submitted a copy of that to Chuck. The watershed area computed downstream of the subject property shows a watershed of 0.37 miles below that expected of a perennial stream. And it goes on and talks about a watershed of 0.5 square miles, etc. And the predicted stream flow is below the 0.01 cubic foot per second at the flow duration. It goes on and mentions 75% or more stratified drift. Streams that show pushing 4 or 5% stratified drift within the watershed area will be far beyond below the 75% figure. What you have is stream stats attached in the back. So those numbers are there. I think we meet the criteria for an intermittent stream.
How did you get the drainage area?
Stream stats.
Can you explain that, please?
Means that in the USGS program that is recommended, in fact, called for by DEP to obtain the area of a watershed.
Okay, I think the critical piece is that we've had previous applications where we've measured the watershed on maps, on 10 maps, and that the watershed upstream of West Street is a square mile. And we've had our engineering department check that and confirm it.
Well, I didn't do the other filings, but I did attach the street stats for the notice of intent, the INRAD, and it clearly shows the watershed area, and you've got the statistics that show the number there. I believe it was 0.14 or 1.4.
There was quite a bit of investigation, quite a bit of confusion, because that watershed extends back into the other side of Austin Prep. There are actually two channels that then ultimately come together. And including both of those put that over the number of square feet.
Actually, it doesn't go there.
I'm sorry, but we have done a model of that stream, and we investigated in the field that watershed, and that's what we're going to go with. Now, what we need to do is work with the engineering department and get that modeling data, and then we need to look at those calculations on a map to see what the square feet are. And so that's my.
Do you recall when this happened, Jamie?
This was maybe 7 years ago, 8 years ago.
It
was for, I think, 21A Summeran.
That was Fagoni.
Fagoni.
Was there another study?
Yes,
for Austin Prep?
No, there was a study done for the town of Reading, flood study, where we modeled the flow in that river. So we need to look at that, because they actually verified the flows in the drainage area, so we need to look at that.
Well, obviously you have the right to look at that, but as far as I'm concerned, we need all the regulatory parameters for an intermittent stream. I don't see where we don't. Of course, if you come up with better information, we can take that, we'll listen to that. If it's not a stream, not an intermittent stream, I don't want to call them intermittent either. So, continue the hearing, present me with that information, and we'll go over it and see if it looks accurate.
I had asked also Chuck to look into, is it Inwood?
Right, so,
that development.
When this came in, it did have bank of the intermittent stream on the plans.
Yes.
And it wasn't my understanding since I started working here in Reading, so I looked into this, and I think there's possibly two studies that Jamie's talking about, maybe a Metcalf and Eddy study, and there's an AECOM study.
Well, AECOM is Metcalf and Eddy.
Oh.
Sorry for the confusion. Yeah, they're the same thing.
So looking at those studies, and George has provided me with some information. So that upper reach of the drainage area is like 450 square feet. I don't know what he said.
Acres.
Yeah, acres. 450 acres. And that's in the study. And it was kind of confusing, because when you do go on stream stats and you start moving that little droplet of water around trying to figure out what's going on, it's not giving me the numbers I'm looking for. So I understand where you're coming up with the one on the 0.14 or the 0.13. And I was confused too. So when we were out there on our site visit, we noticed that Inwood Circle, or Inwood Apartments,
mm-hmm.
was across this area. So I called up Teresa Murphy, the conservation agent in Woburn, and I asked her about all the filings that had to do with that area. And she said, from day one, they've always considered it a riverfront. So there's two conservation commissions with coming up with a similar finding.
I don't know how far away Inwood, how far downstream it might have been.
It's actually this property all but abuts that property.
Yeah, it's directly across.
No, all I can say is, I followed the regulations exactly. The regulations say it's an intermittent stream. If you've got more information, I'm happy to look at it and see if it's accurate.
Yeah,
I'm still going to get you a plan showing the revised vegetated wetland boundary anyhow, so there's no loss on our side.
Steve, is there a reason why you didn't connect the two pieces that as you come off of West Street?
The B&A lines?
Yeah.
They were connected at one time?
Yeah.
connected this to?
They were connected. The neighbors apparently felt I was on their property, and they took the flags and the tags down. So when the surveyor went out there, most of them were gone. In fact, I had to go out there and replace some of the flags recently.
So your intent is to have a continuous line?
That was the intent, but
right.
We may not need it, because the intent is to show that we have potential access off Albert Road, whatever it is.
Arnold Avenue?
Arnold, whatever.
Or Arcadia.
Well, we prefer to go off Arcadia.
Right.
But we have frontage out on the other street. And if necessary, it may be possible to go that way.
Well, help me out here, but it's always been my understanding, once we approve an ANRAD, we are defining all the resource areas on that parcel.
You're defining all the resource areas that I'm showing on the plan. If there's a wetland area that's not shown on the plan, you're not approving that. If there's a floodplain out there and I'm not showing on the plan, you're not approving that. So if I don't have flags out there, just like if I had a wetland somewhere else and there was a wetland that we missed, if I put the flags out there, you have the right at any time to go back and correct that.
Well, I'm not following you then. If we go with this map, is this a resource area?
So
right there? Is this?
It is, yeah. But the boundary is undefined.
So, Jamie, can I give like a what if scenario?
Sure.
What if he didn't care about doing any work over on this side and only cared about the, say, the east side of the site? He only cares about delineating the east side of the site, and he doesn't have to delineate the whole.
The concern is that if we pass this ANRAD, we are saying that this defines the resource areas on the parcel. And if he sells it to somebody else, they come back and they say, well, here's the ANRAD, they're the only resource areas, we're stuck. So as I understand it, it says right here in the site, the parcel consists of 4.62 acres, which is this whole parcel. So if we issue an ANRAD, we're saying what all the resource areas are on that defined parcel. Now, if he wants to show two parcels and show just the resource area in that subparcel, we could probably do that. But to say these are the only resources on this parcel, I don't think that's what he's trying to say.
All I know is there's an upland area on the other side of the wetland. I didn't kayak to go find it.
Chuck. Can you shed some light on a partial?
Sure, so how we write the ORAD is you define the resource areas that the commission has determined are out there. And then there's a space, and you write down all the flags, so you're approving only these flags and only these resource areas, and then you can say things like, other resource areas may exist on the site or outside of the site that this order does not approve. Standard language that goes in there. But there is confusion here because in Reading, before I got here, Jamie's exactly right. That's how it was done.
Hey, that's what we did on the Dana's properties, for example.
Yeah. Okay. But I write them differently. So, and DEP accepts them that way.
Let me give you an example. If you look at this up here,
a good example here too. Like
the land is rising steeply over in this area. I might have upland out there. I'm not asking the commission to determine a boundary in that area, even if there is upland out there. I don't have the time for that.
I think, yes.
Just to comment, I remember working on previous ORADs with you and previous now left members. And I do remember, in that, I think your approach is really a best management practice. And yeah, if we have a chance to identify all the resource areas, we shouldn't miss some that are critical. For example, like vernal pools and special habitats. That said, I also very clearly remember one particular ORAD where we had a long discussion at a couple of meetings that went into, the commission was not comfortable verifying certain flags, that the line specifically that we were not able to agree with even specific flag numbers. And we drafted the ORAD saying explicitly we are not verifying in this ORAD any accuracy associated with flags numbered such and such. And I remember that. So we have done a couple of, I mean, they were minor exceptions, but we have done exceptions in the past.
So we could say, for example,
say the DVW boundary as shown on the plan is accurate.
But I'm still, what would, if we said that this ANRAD defines the wetland line east of flag 13A and west of flag 6B and is silent on the areas between 6B and 13A, that perhaps is something I could live with. But what does that tell me about this spot right here? Is that resource area or not?
Yes.
It is.
Everything on the other side of the flags is a resource
area. All the way up here. That's all. What we're saying then is all this is resource area.
If I was on good sense, but you're only approving the flags that are shown on the plan. If there's an island out there that I didn't flag, I have any right to come back to amend it. But I have no desire to do that. I don't want to go kayaking this time of year.
So this ORAD would only be for those flags.
Steve.
And if you wanted to do anything closer to where it has not been flagged, you would come back with another.
Right, if we don't put a driveway along there.
Or a notice of intent.
Or a notice of intent. I would have to come back. I would expect to come back to amend the ORAD. In the meantime, I can't control if neighbors are taking flags off the land. It's impossible for me to control that.
I don't get what you gain from this.
That's
the main issue is the riverfront. That's what I'm getting.
Okay.
I don't believe it's riverfront. As far as I can see, it meets all the criteria for an intimate street. If there's better information out there,
so
then give it to me. Let's see.
I'm not comfortable with considering this not riverfront because I think there are significant or several studies that indicate that there is potential for riverfront.
If the studies come out and say it is riverfront, then I'll accept that. I don't have a problem with that, but I'd better see the study. I'd better know what they looked at.
Mike, do you have a comment?
No,
so
I mean, I just at this point, we have some line. He's got some more surveying to do. We want to get him some studies. I mean,
why
do we
just
make
a motion
to continue?
Continue. Yeah. You don't care about that.
Yeah. No, actually, if you look at the second page, your out is right there, and it clearly states, conservation staff or competent sources, issuing authorities may consider evidence from other sources better determined to be competent. That's okay with me if you've got another competent source. Let's check it. Let's see what it is.
Anika? Chuck, do you mind pulling up the USGS?
Your map.
Yeah. I downloaded a USGS topo map today that showed the river behind that.
You downloaded a 1981 map, or 84 map, I believe. And the regulation specifically states a river or stream shown as perennial on the current U.S. Geological Survey map or more recent map provided by the Department is perennial.
Do you have a more current 1 to 100,000 squad?
They've updated the maps. Why they updated is beyond me, but presumably they made it better.
Is this the most current up to date 1 to 100?
Chuck, do you mind if it's down there at the bottom? So if you go
Could we ask our engineering department, with the assistance of our GIS department, to calculate, to look at previous calculations and applications, and come up with their estimate of drainage area at that, at the point in question?
Yeah, if you could just zoom in. Yeah, let's go to the, down and to the right.
Abergona River, right there.
Right there.
Right, and there's the stream.
But so they show the Abergona River on this, kind of different location?
Yeah, but can you blow that up where?
So that's exactly the same stream that comes up through Mass GIS Data Viewer as a USGS mapped layer. I mean, the regs doesn't say, the regs don't say it has to be a one to, I'm sorry?
That's not what I get on the GIS.
Well, I printed out my Mass GIS database map, and the USGS streams 100K puts that stream line in the
right,
data layer.
That red line is West Street. Is that?
No, that red line is 129.
The red line, it's
93.
Looking to the right of the ship.
West Street's that black line.
Right.
This is West Street right here.
Right.
Correct.
Yes.
And that's right where we're talking about.
Correct.
And it says Abergona River.
Well,
no, the area.
So
it's the area
we're
talking
about is this one right here.
Correct.
That's not shown on this map.
Yeah, see that?
It's not shown on the
2015.
Ah, that is where Denzran Austin Prep.
No.
There's two channels there. There's one that goes right along Willow Street and one that goes right in Austin Prep.
Yep.
Right.
So when I was looking at the Superfund maps from the EPA,
yeah.
And they actually label the stream that runs behind Arcadia as the south branch of the Abergona River.
It would be the south branch.
Yeah, I mean, you can go out there and you can see that this stream that runs around the Abergona comes under West Street. That's a continuous line
right
here.
You're exactly right.
And this bends around Austin Prep and comes back in, is what our modeling shows. But if we could get our engineering department working with McKiffin/ACOM to give us their calculation of the drainage area at that point, I think that would resolve it, and they can certainly use those calculations that were done for Fagoni's property.
You know, to do that drainage calculation, sorry to interrupt, they would have to have a really good topo.
Well, they did that for the modeling, and they did it at 21A Summer Ave. So we have good topo.
I would like to see that line.
Yeah, that'd be good.
Also, what is
drawn on a topo?
What did Wilbur do to determine this?
The USGS.
I think everybody.
That's what they're saying. 2015.
It's on the current USGS map.
Oh no! What was the last RDA that was filed? You know.
I didn't have an extensive conversation.
Yeah.
Message.
Okay.
Right. Detailed. She got back to me and said, it's a river, it's on the latest USGS map.
Because the Inwood wouldn't have had the 2015, it would have been on earlier USGS. Is it, Anika, is that your USGS?
This is
1984.
This is 1984 Lowell 1 to 100,000 quad. You can, and I think I sent a link on how to download, on how to see some of this.
Yeah,
our applicant earlier.
Yeah.
What?
Our applicant earlier. We point out quickly. We've got it labeled as Abergona River on that too. I mean, this is the same run.
The, go back to,
I think everybody's kind of on the same page. But I think if we've got something available that we can provide the applicant, I think that's what we do.
Yeah.
Well, I think we certainly should provide it to them, but I think we should do an independent calculation of that. And I would also point out that when we did the high school, which is way upstream, although we were probably incorrect, we call that riverfront. And that is way upstream from this location.
Isn't that at the headwaters?
Well, it's not at the headwaters, but it's pretty far upstream from here. Now, and also, one of the correct me if I'm wrong, but one of the criteria for a river is continuous flow, even at certain drought conditions.
Right.
And we observed that river when we were doing the 21A there at Austin Prep, and did see periods during extreme low flow where there was no flow at that spot, but when we went down to West Street, it was flowing under West Street.
And that's the definition of when a stream becomes
a river.
A river is it no longer is intermittent.
We saw a significant flow. You saw it on Sunday, and Chuck, myself, and Harry saw it certainly on Monday. And fairly.
When I first saw it, I flagged it as a riverfront.
We saw the flag.
USGS map.
Yeah, we saw your flag.
It wasn't until I looked at the USGS maps that on the GIS that I downloaded, it did not show it as a perennial stream. It showed it as intermittent. Did not show it at all. In fact, I got that map in New York, IMRAD. And when I get the latest map, 2015 map, doesn't show it. That's what the regulation says, the latest map. Well, that's what I got. So,
okay.
I have no problem going ahead, and if you've got more information, I should change my mind, then I'm happy to change my mind.
Do you have any more questions?
I'm sorry, Chuck, I can't hear you.
This area, if you can see the cursor moving back and
yep.
forth, does this kind of matter if you didn't flag that area? Because we would get 100 foot up in here. I don't know what's happening.
I can show 100 foot up there if you want. I don't have a problem with that.
Because I'm just wondering if we're going to head up the hill on this side too.
Wasn't this 100 foot?
Yeah, but
it is,
so
but it goes around the corner.
So as you make a radius, as you make the radius, then all of a sudden it's going to pop everything out.
It's very
yeah.
close to that if it's not at that. So I have no problem showing up.
Yeah.
But wouldn't you need the flag?
Yeah.
I could. I just can't guarantee how long I'm going to be there. Well, I'll tell you what I'll do is I'll meet the surveyor out there when I flag it and when he locates the other flags. And he can locate it at the same time if someone takes them down and know where they were.
So we did move some flags. We didn't move them. We wrote down what we wanted.
Could
you
give me that list and I'll move them?
Do I have that list?
I have my list at home. Sorry.
We'll provide you with a list.
Yes.
I was bad. I'm bad today.
We'll provide you a list. Was 3 feet the most or generally what we did?
Yeah.
It was
maybe
in some cases
feet.
There wasn't much of a move,
yeah.
just the other side of the tree.
3/10 of an inch on
right.
on an inch scale.
And I know I hit one and it fell again. So.
Yeah, it's not a big deal. Sometimes you hang on the nearest shrub.
Yeah, kind of fell down. Did that on my way. So bad. Okay. Are there any questions from the public?
Maybe you should summarize.
I'm wondering if any commission members are actually neighbors.
Excuse me, could you identify yourself, please?
My name is Doris.
Neighbors of each other?
Neighbors
of
our community.
Still
the
abutters?
The movement is addressing its neighbors, moving flags, and just wondering if your neighbors. No?
No.
No.
No further questions.
What was that, moving flags and seeing neighbors?
Well, he was saying that neighbors are moving flags, and you guys had said that you moved flags.
Oh, no, we didn't.
Didn't
sorry.
Physically
we
move.
Move flags. I've been notation as to where I thought. Well, we thought that the wetland should go a little further up. I did hit one flag and it fell down. I didn't mean to. I tried to stick it back as best I could. Yes, your name again?
My name is Maria Salvatelli, 25 Arnold Avenue. That corner wedge right there. Can you please clarify whether it's the gentleman over here that's representing the client or you guys? Can you please clarify exactly what it is he's trying to accomplish with this meeting? And just so we have, in layman's terms, so we understand.
Notification of resource delineation.
Okay.
What he's trying to get from us as the commission is the location of wetland resource areas, and that's, you know, swamp.
Right.
It can be floodplain, 100-year floodplain. It can be a bank of a stream, things like that. And we also have jurisdiction within 100 feet of those resource areas.
Or
so
200.
And if it were a riverfront,
mm-hmm.
a perennial stream, then it would also have two other additional areas of concern. The inner riparian zone is from the top of the bank out 100 feet, and then from 100 feet to 200 feet is the outer riparian zone. If it were indeed a riverfront, we would have jurisdiction on that whole 200 feet from the top of the bank.
If I could just expand on that a little bit. I don't mean to speak for the applicant, but typically the reason people do this is to understand where the jurisdictional areas are on their property, and they are the areas they cannot build on or develop. So they like to know what areas are out of bounds, so to speak, before they lay out a development plan. That is typically why people do this.
So once we concur and come to some agreement with the applicant and the applicant's consultant, Mr. Steve Erickson, then we would issue an ORAD?
Yes, order.
Order of a resource determination. And then from there, if they were able to put any kind of a development on that area of the parcel 15, then they would have to file another permit with us to do that work, because they were in that those resource areas and within the buffer zones, you know, with the 25, 35, and then 100 or 200, whichever that
applies.
And as it stands now, as a river,
we don't know that yet.
If it were a river,
mm-hmm.
you know, making the assumption that it stands as a river, how much land, because I'm trying to understand, because
there are severe restrictions on what can be done within the riverfront. I don't want to say that nothing can occur, but if there is development, particularly in the inner riverfront, then there has to be mitigation and compensation.
And then a question to the, I guess, directed to him, is because he would be the client at this stage, is what are the intents, what are your intentions of this property? And why now, and how long have you had the property for?
Well, first off, keep in mind, I'm not the engineer, I'm the wetland guy, okay?
Okay.
But if it were me, I'd be building it for a single-family home, and I assume that's what my client is going to do, just a single-family home. Not enough room for anything else on it. And the reason that we filed for the riverfront and the wetland boundary is so that we don't design something and then have the boundary change and then have to redesign it.
Right.
All right? By getting it fixed, we know it's going to be there, we know that's not going to change, so we can go ahead with the design and not worry about having to make little Mickey Mouse changes later
right.
on in the process.
You had mentioned something about on the Arnold Ave side, trying to get on that side, you said? Is that accurate, you said?
We don't want to do that, right?
You can't do that, can you?
Well, this is what's called a limited project, all right? So we have access over here and frontage over here. It's conceivable that he could carry a driveway all the way here and onto the property. I wouldn't want to do it. It would be expensive, and he would have to compensate for any wetland that he takes out. So by the time he got through compensating for that wetland area, he'd lose a whole lot of land here. It may be feasible, but I don't know that.
So how much would you,
it's important to realize, it's important to realize that there is no current plan.
Right. Okay,
that the idea of this process is to figure out a line so that they can figure out what to work with.
Yeah,
there are
kind of
a lot of options after that.
Excuse me, can I speak? Sal Maggs of 105 Arcadia Ave. Thank you for telling us that, but we know the intent. Okay, so what I've heard tonight, and excuse my ignorance, what I've heard tonight is nothing but lines. No one here has talked about, and I don't know if this falls under your jurisdiction, no one here has talked about the snapping turtles that are on the property. No one's talked about the vegetation that's on that property. And if you want to come and have a drink with me and watch the vegetation grow from the spring to the summer to the fall, you're more than welcome. Okay? So I don't know, and let me tell you something, my backyard is where we're talking about, and I see the vegetation, and I appreciate the vegetation, and no one's actually talking about the animals, and no one's talking about all the other things that go on back there. Now, I don't know if this is in your jurisdiction or not, but I don't want this just to be focused on a line right now. And it might be me, but I don't know if vegetation's part of this conversation, if snapping turtles are on this.
Just a second. I can help you out with the animals real quick. We don't protect animals.
That's not correct.
Well, Chuck, then you protect their habitat.
Chuck,
so
I went through this process with you guys,
so
and I know for a fact that you protect
the
animals.
There's eight interests of the Act, and not one of them says we're protecting animals. But it's their habitat, which in turn does protect the animals.
But my point is, I'm a little frustrated that we've only talked about the line, and maybe it's my ignorance that I don't know what you guys actually have under your preview, but I'll tell you, and we've got videos that snapping turtles come out, lay their eggs, and we've got videos of this every year, and my kids are on it, and my neighbor's kids are on it, and they appreciate that, and we watch them come out of their hole, okay? So I don't, educate me, I'm a little frustrated about the vegetation and the animals that are back there.
Can I take a shot at it?
Sure, go ahead.
What we're talking about now is what area on that parcel is a wetland. And what we understand, and it's written into our regulation, the qualities and the benefits of a wetland, and they include wildlife habitat, they include vegetation, they include water quality. So we're not discussing that because that's in our regulation, we all understand that. We'd be happy to discuss that with you if you would like. So there's no question, even by the applicant or anybody on the commission, that they are wetlands on that site, and that those wetlands represent the vegetation you're talking about and the wildlife habitat you're talking about. That's no question. We're in total agreement with that. The question before this board is, where exactly is that line? Where do the wetlands start? Where does it stop? And as we've talked about, the applicant put out a line. We went ahead and looked at it. We moved it a little bit. So we're reaching the point that we agree where that line is, what is wetlands, what is not. Once we are in concurrence with that, then we will issue this, approve this map as modified to show where that wetland line is. The one question that is still open is whether or not that channel is in fact an intermittent stream or whether it's a permanent stream, the Arizona River. And that is something we have to do more research on. But there's no question by anybody as to whether or not there are wetlands on that site. And there is no question, at least in my mind, of the value of those wetlands with respect to the characteristics that you mentioned. It's just, where do they start? Where do they stop?
So I have Eric Fournier, Arnold Ave. My understanding from civil engineer friends of mine is that the wetlands can continue to grow over time. If that is the case, are we adjusting and looking at the line for that? Have we done any studies to see where that line has moved over time?
This line is good for 3 years, in which case it would have to be redefined. 3 years is, quite frankly, a bit of a compromise. Wetlands are usually stable for about that length of time. When we do have to reevaluate after 3 years, we see little or no movement. Now, with climate change, that might change, but still, the 3 years is I think a reasonable time frame.
Follow-up question: I know that some of you have done sidewalks. According to statements you've made, have you done a formal sidewalk together as a group to look through that to determine together and collectively where the line actually is?
We've done it in groups of one or two. We try and get together and do it all at the same time. Unfortunately, we had some severe scheduling difficulties this week, and people didn't meet at the right time at the right place.
We had three people and our administrator.
Went
did
out
you
today.
Go?
Yeah, I went
okay.
out today.
So
take a look.
Majority of us went and took a look at this.
Was site. That just so you had some preliminary information for tonight's meeting, or was that a formal site walkthrough?
It's a formal site walk conducted by the commission prior to the meeting. We do that as a matter of course.
But it's only to gather information. We can't discuss or
right.
argue or whatever.
We can't make a definitive determination.
Right.
You know, we have to vote as a full body commission.
In public.
Right.
We have to have a public discussion.
It's a public
meeting. Right. Has everybody done a site walkthrough? Just a show of hands.
How about who hasn't? A lot of them have.
I have seen that wetland. I have not seen the flags.
Al, have you been out there?
No, I didn't go.
And Amy hasn't been out there, and I think that's it.
Yeah.
So can you again, Miranda Salvatelli, 25 Ronald, can you explain to me how, so we, as I mentioned, 25 Ronald Avenue, we have to go through a process to just cut a couple of trees down on our property, which is not on the wetland. So I'm trying to understand is like, why is it that there's such confusion as to where the wetland is? Because obviously
your trees were within
right.
the buffer zone.
Right.
You had to file. Same with anything
and
that any work that they do.
Us.
Any work that they do, the same thing.
So Greg Salvatelli, 25 Arnold Avenue, same house. I grew up in that lot. I mean, I bought that for my parents. So I've seen that river throughout my life. It has not changed. It's been there. And yes, you probably could kayak throughout times. And I played in it as a kid when I probably shouldn't have, maybe. But anyways, my point was, when we did take down some trees around our house, we had the Conservation Commission come out. And they said there was a 100-foot buffer zone and a 200-foot buffer zone. So they were considering a river bed.
Right. That's exactly right.
And they said there was ferns that were protected. You could not, you could not go back there even to call out some of the ones that maybe were dangerous of falling. We didn't want to touch those areas. So our own conservation committee has already said at one point
right.
in recent
history. We have historically said that that's riverfront. You're exactly right. And until we're proven wrong, we will, that's where we've been. And the applicant has a chance to do that.
Excuse me, may I ask you a question? Have you seen it dry up? That area back there.
Can I answer that question?
No, I'm
asking him.
Okay. Yeah. We've been there for 11 years now. Never.
I have not seen it dry up. I mean, Jimmy's probably the one maybe a little longer in the neighborhood than me.
I've been there my whole life.
And how long have you been there?
I've been there 50 years.
And your name, sir?
Jim Steenbruggen, 29 Edgemont Avenue. I've lived there all my life. I've never seen that dry.
Never.
The parcel that's behind their house where the stream goes through where the wetlands are was a pond at one time until 93 they put the tunnel and they cleaned
right.
out the tunnel and it vacated. And
yeah.
now we just have the stream running through there.
Yeah.
But I used to ice skate on that pond and it was a pond.
Yeah,
and that stream has never gone dry. As long as I've been around and I've been
is
down there all my
your
life.
Parcel is not on that map.
I am not in the butter.
Hi, my name is Lisa Rauchy. I live at 117. I am one of those parcels. That river literally wraps around my property. I have an 18-year-old boy now. He was very lucky to grow up in an area like this. I can tell you, I've been there for 12 years. Like Jimmy's been there a lot longer, and I'm sure there's many other people that have been there longer than me. I have never seen that river dry down there. I've plucked my son out of there more times than I can tell you. And last week on college spring break, he and my other neighbor, he's right here, where were they all day? Down playing in the water, down in the river. I mean, we know this area. We take pride in this area. Never seen it dry.
Thank you very much.
Earl Andrews, 37 Arnold Ave. If you want to make a take a walk around, just go to 37 Arnold Ave and walk on the back of that property, and you'll see the stream right there, and that continues to go into the Woobin at
yeah.
the end of Arnold Ave there,
yeah.
and like they talked about, it goes underneath 93. It's there all the time.
Okay.
It's never dried up.
Thank you very much. At this point, I've got a lot of confirmation from you as abutters that there's a lot of water back there, and I think we did see that for ourselves. But I would like to move on, and we are going to probably have a.
I make a motion to continue.
Okay.
Do we have a?
Actually, did we, is there a hearing for an NRAD? I don't think you read the.
Yeah, we opened up a hearing.
It is no, no.
No.
Oh, okay.
It's not a public meeting, it's a public hearing.
It is a public hearing.
It's a public hearing, not a meeting. Well, I don't have to read that.
Oh, that would make it a meeting, not a hearing.
To be public.
So we don't have to continue.
So we don't have to continue.
No, we can just put it on the next agenda.
We should check, make sure it's okay with that.
Is that okay with,
Oh, right.
To continue, absolutely.
On the continuance, are you gonna have an open? I didn't hear.
Sir, could you?
Did you, yeah, Dave Belchi, 117 Arcadia, I wasn't sure when you were mentioning the new hearing that you're gonna have with, is it gonna be an open public hearing?
Yes.
Absolutely.
Yes.
Just, I didn't want to make sure.
Yeah.
Thank you. Also.
The next continuation would be open.
Yes.
You know, we meet every other Wednesday or the second and fourth Wednesday of each month.
April 13th would be the next meeting.
April.
Yep.
Could I just add one other thing about the blue markers that somebody here said that the neighbors removed? I was raking my yard last fall and one of them was in my yard.
Yeah.
You know, maybe your surveyors didn't put them on as nice as you thought they did. I never saw anybody taking them off, so thank you, that's all I wanted to say.
One thing that we should mention is, you know, April 13th would be the next meeting.
I don't know if the information will be available, and then if not, it would be the following. But check with, you post the agenda how many days in advance?
So the agenda is usually posted a week in advance, but everyone should contact the town clerk and sign up for the agendas to all the meetings in town that they call this, this work and this application, so that you wouldn't have to rely on calling me.
So there's no new abutters notice?
Jack, yeah.
There won't be a.
You just have to be vigilant, you guys as abutters, you need to be vigilant and go online and see where the meetings are and see if it's on the agenda.
So, but let me say, feel free to call me. No, I didn't want that to sound bad.
Wait a minute, Chuck.
To get the agenda from the town clerk.
What we've had in similar situation, one abutter or one neighbor has kind of taken the lead and call Chuck, find out, and then notify the other neighbors.
Here's the other comment, Chuck. Don't we always put the continuation,
agenda,
even if it's not, if there's no information? So don't they need to find out from you? If it's, we've had that with Randall Road.
Yeah, it'll be on the agenda no matter what.
Yeah.
Right?
Yep, it will.
So just let you know, and you don't get really mad at us. Please do find out if the applicant has the information available for that particular meeting, because we've had the situation where it's on our agenda, but they don't have the information. It just gets continued. Do you understand that?
So we'll just go to the next meeting. So as Jamie said, the best option is if you can have kind of one person kind of take the lead to say, hey, contact Chuck a couple days before and say, do you know if the applicant is going to be there? He should have a good idea on the Monday before or what it is. But that way, you have it's going to be on the agenda no matter what.
So the agenda will be accurate up to the Monday before, and if they continue it, we'll have a little blurb on there that says, continued at the applicant's request. But after Monday, you're going to have to call.
Yes, sir. One last question, please.
When do you talk about the water that's
Could
there?
You identify yourself, please?
Bob Lynch, 24 Shelby Road, 32 years there now. Minus 12. I spent 20 years down there riding dirt bikes with my son. From the cul-de-sac there, I've had at least 5 different storms that have put 3 to 4 inches of rain on that cul-de-sac, going all the way across as far as you can see.
Yep.
Don't know what happens when it dries up a little bit, but if you're going to base on when it dries up a little bit, what do you base the water that comes when it rains? You know, as far as seeing it dried up, there's always water down there. At least at the cul-de-sac end, as you look in up diagonally from the map there,
far as you can see, it may not be a total sheen of water, but there's water there. Now, I don't know whether you're talking about water that's there sometimes, or just delineating whether it's a river or a stream. Fish come up that river, the Abajona River, they come underneath 93, they go up through the center port there. I've seen fish behind the Chandler's house, which is down on Arcadia Ave, three or four houses up from this. I've seen fish coming up the stream at that point.
Thank you. You have a motion?
Motion to continue.
Do I hear a second?
Second.
All those in favor? Nope.
She's in favor.
All right. So, Steve,
you.
Will you
Steve.
Have enough information for the next meeting, or you?
Well, if I get the studies,
yeah, we
got
to figure out the
flag numbers for you.
Okay.
I should be able to get the surveyor up there and set up with him to change those flags.
Okay.
If I don't, I'll let you know. Yeah. Command
and
process.
And Chuck, you're going to talk to George's office.
Steve.
It's just the show, man.
It's never clear what his intent is. He's represented. I don't understand what the sneakiness is or the mystery behind it.
It's on the sheets, I think. He signed it as representative. Where is it? Here.
A lot of things.
See, here's the applicant, Joan Hooper.
Oh, okay.
And being represented by Norris Environmental.
And that's him.
That's him.
And but what's her intention?
Excuse
thank
me, we just
everybody.
Asked. We
she
just asked
tell
that
us we
have
don't know.
A couple more meetings to
her intention right now
yeah,
is to find out where the wetlands are.
Thank you.
Thank you.
They'll come back
you're
to
welcome.
Us with their intentions. But if we approve that as riverfront, she might just say, I can't build there and we'll never see her again.
Yeah. Wow. This guy seems to represent a lot of people. Is he the only
it's just, no, they're probably
person.
About 10 people that we see frequently. He's just,
okay.
You just
oh,
have
yeah.
to have two in a row.
Wow, they're talking about a lot of.
Springvale Road, no.
What?
No, they're
residents, angry residents, huh?
Yeah, this is like these two. These two properties we rarely see that.
We'll put them right in the main. Not even, it wasn't even like the old new business or the additional something. Right?
So Chuck, can't will you will check with George in his office?
Yeah, I was gonna tell you I've been working on it with George for 2 weeks.
Okay, good. I would also say, Madam Chairman, that. If engineering cannot respond in a timely manner, we might have to hire a third party. Because we don't want to hold up the applicant. What?
I mean, I understand.
You can go down and look at it. In the summer, it's like that deep and flowing.
It doesn't try. It doesn't have a clear bank.
I don't understand
it doesn't have a clear
how you can an engineer stream
only when it's flowing hard. I could make an argument. Don't ask me.
I can see Steve's. I mean, not being from
when
around here. If you look it up on stream stats.
That was the one you
The stream stats, though, has the drinking area wrong.
You know, we use that.
He followed the
yeah.
steps that they said to follow.
That's right.
And whether or not it led him to, I think, a conclusion. Not that it's correct, but it led him to a conclusion. I mean,
we know that whole high school drains to it. We know that whole marsh by P&S store drains to it. And he's saying it's 60 acres? Come on.
There's a software that they tell you to use that says it's that?
I know. It's just a lot of things are wrong.
Yeah,
I've seen flood maps that are very wrong.
Absolutely.
That's why I wanted to do was look at Google.
Really? They are not. I'm just
shocked. She went to throw them off.
You know what? Jamie, if you look at 420 West Street.
It says river right there.
Abajona.
So, Jamie.
Perennial.
I would really like to send you some emails, and it might be time for you to talk to Bush too, because I've been working with him. We really gonna do that.
Okay. We've lost our chair.
I have to say, that was the first time I ever thought I was gonna kill the Muslim.
What did Chuck say?
Thought he was getting killed.
Well, you said the other day, my daughter thought, I told her this, she thought this was hilarious.
Welcome
so we
to
have this long, drawn-out story about the expression to kick the dog when you've had a bad day. And then he said to one of the neighbors, you get two kicks at the cat. My daughter thought that was really funny after the dog story. So I was interviewing a woman, and I had a colleague, a junior colleague, who... I said, why don't you join me for this interview? It would be a good experience for you. So we're interviewing this woman. And she was coming in as a proposal writer for us, very sort of a technical job for us. And she said, so what's it like to work here? And we've gone back and forth on a bunch of topics. And I said, well, you know, we have our good days and our bad days. And sometimes you want to go home and kick the dog. And I'm thinking that's just an expression that someone had used that I thought, you know, I'd heard it. You kick your dog? No, I love dogs. I know plenty of dogs. You know, the whole, it was, she got on the elevator and we fell down laughing. It was so funny. Yeah, I kick dogs all day long.
Yeah.
Took it literally.
Yeah. That's why she's a proposal writer. It was pretty funny.
Can we have our chair back?
Oh, we don't have the chair anyway.
I should do it.
Becky, is the sign on the?
Yes.
Okay.
I thought we lost you.
Thought we lost you. So we on tree poles.
Thought you were in a kayak on the Abrajona ditch.
Yeah, I couldn't get my. We've got update on the tree policy right next, but I was thinking maybe we could do. We have.
Well, if we have citizens here for
25 spring.
Yeah, let's so they
yeah,
can.
Yeah, let's do that.
So
in one general way, I believe.
Do we have anybody here for one general way?
Yes, someone should be.
Okay. We'll do that after Springvale Road. So, we have a ORAD to.
I thought we were
done.
Yeah,
I don't know why the.
It's a.
What did we do before smartphones?
Yeah, ORAD.
Right.
ORAD.
We sign the.
Time to sign the ORAD.
Right.
Okay.
So yeah.
Did you guys look at it?
Why is the general public here?
I did email it out to everyone. And
it's on my agenda.
I'd like to see the map.
The map.
Yeah.
Final
map.
That was emailed to everybody also.
About a month ago?
About a month ago.
I might have it.
The final, a month ago, we didn't have that isolated wetland.
March 7th, I think, was the date on the map.
Is this it, Chuck?
Yeah, let me get the.
Date 7?
This might be it.
Bless you.
It's the most recent one I have.
Yeah, I've got those two pieces.
Is it dated March?
It's dated March.
Right.
March 4th.
We did have it. I remember calling
flag
it that day.
Flags, A, B, C, and D.
Yeah, there
you go.
There
we go. Safety.
So it goes D1 to 5, is that right? It's a little confusing. 1, 2, 3.
F by A, B, C, D.
So D1, D2,
D3.
4.
4.
4.
Wait a minute, what's that one? 3.
There's one there. And there's, oh, D.
D1, 2,
3. Those were originally, then, oh, C.
So we added A.
A.
change to one of the findings?
And I sent it back to you.
Okay.
How about right there? Is there a flag right there?
You did reword it.
Right there.
I think it's
right
C.
There.
Thank you.
Yeah, no
you
problem.
You think that's C?
Yeah, capital C.
Did you?
A, B.
I did. I didn't see. I could see.
C,
I didn't.
D. Right.
Mm-hmm. And these were original. D1, D2.
So that we have an A wetland. Is there a B wetland? B wetland. Is there a C wetland? There's a C wetland.
There was a C wetland, but that doesn't qualify.
Trying here.
It didn't meet the 500.
Yeah.
Then my concern is, what is the jurisdictional wetland on this map? Does it anywhere say what it is? Because there are all these areas shown, but which ones are actually jurisdictional?
Well,
do we say that in the words, Chuck?
No, but this
What's
one
that?
Is 48 square feet.
WFA 1 through WFA 16.
Right.
WFD 3. I'm sorry, WF. No, I'm sorry.
Yes, it's a little confusing
yeah.
through there. You want to read it off here?
Sure. Thank you.
Is this
a finding?
Is that the text
finding
that
number
goes
two.
With the map?
Yes.
Yeah.
This is kind of what Chuck was talking about before, where he actually lists the wetland
the
flags.
Flags.
Oh, okay, good. That's what I need to look at then.
So,
any references this 3/4/16 date?
Yes. That's the reference for the.
That's the latest.
I think I lost the pages, but yeah.
Last revised March 4, 2016.
Okay.
So it's that one here.
Yep.
Seven parcels, 81,000 square feet.
Do you want me to list the flags that are numbered?
Sure. Go ahead.
Ready? So wetland flags numbered. Lowercase WFA 1 through lowercase WFA 16.
Wait a minute, here's
that's
six,
the
one,
WFA 1
on
the
16. Check.
Comma.
Oh, wait, 16, okay.
Okay, lowercase WFB 1 through lowercase WFB 3.
Yep.
Placing WF. Wait, that should
four.
Be corrected.
No, I think that's
oh,
correct.
4B 1.
Yeah.
Through WF4B3, connecting back to WFB5 and WFT6.
Wait a minute, say that again.
Okay. They added, say it again.
I don't know if I got, all right, WFB1 through WFB3.
Yeah.
Placing WF4B1 through WF4B3.
Will be 2, will be 3, right here.
Connecting back
two.
To WFB5 and WFT6.
Say T?
Yeah.
FB6.
Oh.
It's got the FB6.
We'll change that.
That's finding 2.
So this line is what we're
didn't even write it right.
Referencing?
Yeah. It's this one was this.
There's more.
To 16.
There's more.
Then
yes,
this is that. You know, kind of like a wet
did
and
did we mess
area.
Up all Chuck's pages?
And then, okay.
And
what's
and then
ready for the next? Then WFD1, WFD2, WF3, capital A.
Right.
WFD3, capital B.
You're an expert. Pick them up and help.
WF capital C, WF capital D.
And that's it?
Connecting back to WFD4.
No, we wait until
FD5
right.
finish this thing.
5 and goes into FD1.
What's habit right there?
And then so the last sentence says.
Area of 4, 6.
No, but what does it go from W?
I think so.
Anika, does it go from WFD5 back to FD1?
Yes.
Because that's not. Consistent with this, there's another point right there.
No, where?
Right there.
That's it, FD1.
Oh, okay.
And then the next sentence says additional resource area boundaries may exist on adjacent properties outside the limits of the delineation shown on the approved plan.
Okay.
Is it silent on these WFC1 through WFC4?
Yes.
Yes, because it's only 48 square feet. And
I understand that, but it's, I mean, it could be confusing to some future conservation
committee. I mean, you could add a sentence saying that those series flags
I would feel better saying that.
Area.
That's not, yeah.
An area.
Yeah, or they're not jurisdictional due to size. Because somebody might just whip at that map and say this is.
That would eliminate any confusion on anyone's part.
I'd like to see that added.
So we're adding wetlands that don't exist?
That were flagged and on the map. But.
Just noting that.
Just noting.
Just noting that they're not considered jurisdictional wetlands.
Flag F would be.
It's a.
The
C series.
C, 1, 2, 3, 4.
Yes.
Are non-jurisdictional.
That's
right.
Although shown on the map are non-jurisdictional. Okay. I can do that. Do you feel comfortable to sign with that change?
Yes.
I'm comfortable, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Where do I sign? I'll just pass it around.
So just to let the public know, we're just trying to put into written document, and what we're signing now is just the written document that specifies, you know, in sentence form what's shown on the plan.
Is my interpretation correct that is the WF is wetlands flag?
Yes.
And the next one is the dressing?
The next one is what?
The area it addresses, C, D.
Yes.
Yes.
Right.
And then the final one is the number of the flag they set in that
correct
section.
And there were blue flags and a silver tag, and the WFD5 is on the silver tag.
I didn't see many silver tags left out there.
Neighbor.
I know I'm not supposed to talk. Sorry.
It's flagged and it's mapped, so
at this point it's on the survey. They can relocate it if they needed to.
Have you seen the blue flags?
Do we have the survey point charts? The GPS locations for those flags?
No.
The GPS locations?
Or the.
We have a plan.
We have a plan.
Do we
use
it?
Right. But
just what we
can we get the electronic?
Do we usually ask for electronic?
I don't think we typically
do.
We never ask for the GPS coordinates for each flag.
No.
They have them, though.
I'm sure they do.
Oh, yeah, they do have it.
But they have it.
We can ask them to put them back anytime.
I mean,
pardon me?
We do have the approved plan. I mean, that might be old school now, but.
Well, I guess. I don't want to beat a dead horse, but if you're going out to develop this and the flags are off.
They have their own locations to relocate, and they have to put them back. And we can confirm that they're
the
correct locations.
Have to talk to the conservation office anyways, even though it's a building permit.
You will note that something's missing.
And the final thing, which is accepted in this town, that has to happen before they can break down, is there's a pre-activity meeting. That's when I go out. And if they weren't up there, if they were there a week ago and now they're not there and I was worried about it, you can make them put the flags back in.
I think in the future that when we finally agree on the wetland flag location, that they produce a final map and a sheet showing the GPS location of each flag. Because they have it, all you do is press a button on a computer.
So in the future, we could have them provide a table, whether it's on the plan or something separate that just has the XY coordinates.
Right. I think that in this day and age, that's a smart thing to do.
Well, do we want to make that a new
standard
going forward, or do we want to say, if this data has already been generated, then it must be submitted?
we put that through enough. I mean, it's up to you, but I'm just in the future going forward.
There are a couple times when, let's say, our administrator assists people in setting up those flags. You know, and maybe a survey is done where it's not.
Yeah, right.
You know
right.
What I mean? I'm just saying.
I'm talking about for an NRED primarily is what I'm talking about, because it could be 3 years before they act.
I wouldn't want somebody going out and trying to replicate those flags off the plan that's not a licensed registered engineer.
Right.
Survey.
Right. Yeah. So,
right.
You know, if
right.
it's resurfacing a deck, that I don't see that. But for an NRED, I think it makes sense to have it.
I just think right now we're kind of resetting a new document, you know, a new submittal requirement that we haven't asked for in the past. And I think it's a good suggestion so that the data is most useful in town hall. I just want to make sure we just think about all the different applications.
I don't
that
think
come
it's
in.
A bad idea.
I don't either.
I agree.
I just don't think we can demand it from every single applicant.
No.
No.
I
don't think so. Oh. Did you guys finish?
Yes.
All right. Any further comments from folks here for Springvale, Randall?
Yeah, I think so.
Yeah.
I think
this guy, that guy, this lady. one, two, and another lady.
Well, let's get going with this plan on the wall before
yeah,
I lose my good luck with
oh.
the air show here.
Okay, but I'll have to lay sideways.
You're going to do a rotate 90 here.
I don't even know if there's any way to do
sorry,
that.
Sorry,
what's
going
doing?
On?
What's
the
matter?
What are we doing?
Yeah, what is this?
We're
asked
done.
If he had something to say, and he happened to have a plan, but it didn't have enough copies, so I put it up there.
Oh, okay.
So this is Randall Road. You asked them if they any abutters has anything to say.
Oh, okay.
Here you go.
Oh, thank you.
Can you just have your name, please? I'm sorry.
Oh, okay. Peter Shields.
Thank you.
You're
Harry Curtis?
Harry Curtis. Good. Write that down. Okay. This, you folks just discussed, this is the non-jurisdictional wetland.
Right.
Correct.
So then, ignore the blue. Okay, because that's 35 feet as you go around. So that kind of blows away. This is Lake Donovan. The owner of the next property that's sitting over here. And nobody was fighting this to be in wetlands here. And the pinky is where you see. Okay. I don't see where this. These are actual. Yeah. All right. And then this one. Okay. And this is a buffer for the red. The 35-foot buffer. Coming around here, maybe early. And this is the.
D series.
Isolated. Yes.
What?
Isolated. Yep.
Okay. Yep. This is
got a couple
the first delineation. This is the second for the same area. And this is a buffer goes around
correct.
This guy. I'm glad it's up here because he's smudge. let's see. This whole ditch here is a wetland. And this extends out to here. So this whole swash here is also wetlands.
When they come before us, they will identify these areas, like the 25-foot no-build zone, 35-foot. Is that what you're getting at?
I was doing this to show stay-away zones, I guess.
Mm-hmm.
And so this... Here, nobody's complaining about that. This is a ditch over here. That's the buffer zone for the ditch. These are the flags that go with Lake Donovan. And this is the buffer zone for Lake Dunham. So, and I allow them to overlap, so it's a double win. This is a buffer zone for this. This is Randall here, and the other side of it is probably around here someplace. Have I confused the issue?
No, we're perfectly
clear.
Perfectly clear.
This is just the 35-foot buffer.
Do you have a question, or are you confused about something?
I don't think I am.
Okay. Did you have a question? No?
No, I responded to my dad here.
Okay,
thank you.
Okay, thank you.
All right, if you got another one, I'll hop up again.
Okay.
No?
Thank you.
Thank you.
Welcome.
All right. So we're done with spring.
Randall?
Yep.
So any other questions?
Any other questions from the public? Okay.
Thank you. All right.
Is this goodbye?
One general
That's
way.
Is this final as of now, this minute?
Yes. Well, it was when we signed.
Okay. So is the final date today or tomorrow? What's the date that this is a final plan?
So
be
it's
today,
the 24th?
So the state, it's a 10-day appeal for the state. But for the local bylaw, it's a 60-day appeal from the point that the meeting was closed, which was at the last meeting. So there's two different appeals that can happen.
Okay, there's two different final dates. Okay, I just wanted to, talking appeal per se.
Usually what happens is they go with the 10-day appeal period, I would think that a notice of intent would come in quickly with this.
A lifetime.
Springtime's here.
I'm not sure that's right.
So can we pick up a copy of this signed document like tomorrow or the next day? Or?
Yep, you sure can. You can come in and pick up a copy anytime after 1 or 2 o'clock.
Okay, so the document is final as of the 24th, and we can get a copy. That's all I wanted to know.
Yep.
Okay.
Great.
One general way. We've had a continuation on one general way. We did meet with the applicant's consultant. What?
Please describe who we met with the applicant's consultant.
The administrator and I, the chairman, met with our town manager, the assistant manager, representatives from Danis and Danis's consultant on Monday afternoon, and it was really basically to go over our state wetlands filing fee and also the filing fee under our Reading general bylaw. We didn't get a definitive everything identified. And we've asked that the applicant's consultant come back with, each of those areas of cost. And that's about it.
It's a little unusual for the town manager to get involved in a filing fee. What was the impetus for that?
I don't know.
That's a great question. I wish you were there to ask it, but I didn't.
You didn't ask the question?
Well, what were the questions? What were the issues? What was the discussion?
They wanted to know where they could reduce the fee for the upcoming notice of intent application based on what they saw as the fees that's going to be generated through that process. Flood zone, delineation,
bank.
Verification, bank,
work
within the 25,
area.
Work within the 35.
And what did the town manager and the assistant
they
town
sat
manager
and
say?
Listened. They had, they were, at the end, I think Gene just thought that me and John should work together.
John.
Leave
Dick.
It open. Thank you.
You don't have the authority to discount those fees, do you?
No.
No.
Only the commission can do
but
that.
But I have.
The town manager can't do it.
I certainly have the I know, I guess I feel confident that if I could work with John for a little while and help him, you would have less time arguing over fees.
You'd know
at
what,
that point.
You'd know
so I could bring it in a more condensed package, not reducing any, but getting him to be more concise about what we currently do.
I don't think anybody can get him to be more concise.
Yeah. So, for instance, we usually don't charge anything for invasive removal.
Right.
That needs to be said right away. So there should be no argument about that. So that's 20 minutes right off the top that we're not talking about at the meeting. And that's why I'm meeting with John, okay?
Yeah, I'm just wondering, I mean, was
so,
that your 11 o'clock Monday?
What's that?
Was that your 11 o'clock meeting
no.
Monday?
No.
Was it 11?
No. No, I met with you at 11.
We met at 11, and then I went site visits at 3, and then I had a meeting with them at 4:30.
So John called the town manager and finagled the meeting, and you had to go.
I don't know how it happened.
Yeah.
Basically.
Well, if you calculated the fee without any modifications, just strict interpretation, what kind of numbers are we talking about?
15 grand on a project that he thinks is going to be 20,000.
15,000 in fees.
Mm. So most of that is bank.
Right. Of course. So yeah.
Even most of it. It's like 6,600 in bank.
And then another 7 for work within the buffer zone.
700.
700 for industrial work. You know, you're working in an industrial area. There was a delineation of about 1,500.
So
the delineation.
I may have been new to the commission at this point, but didn't we already approve a reduced rate for
that
property?
That was for a different
application.
Remember when they were going to cut everything coming in?
But there wasn't
on the left.
They didn't actually
apply
right? at that point.
No, they actually were so.
We were talking about it.
We
though,
were talking
about the $500,000 price tag of that fee. They came in and talked to us. They actually so I did the review because we have something to sign on this property tonight. So that was an ecological restoration project that John Dick brought in as an RDA. So. All right, I guess I only find that funny, but
little administrator humor.
Yeah, that's all the other administrators around are laughing. So it doesn't work. So that, it was more about John being creative, and John from Hancock is a very, very creative consultant. So.
That's it.
So
and I don't
we reduced that to between 5,000, if you're asking, between 5,000 and 7,500. We asked them to kind of did it like this is the number where we want to be around. There wasn't really any rhyme or reason to it. And we asked John to go back and kind of add, figure out where that would end up becoming charged. So delineation of the, or verification of the flags. How much is in the 25 foot, how much is in the 35 foot. We have two fees for that kind of work. But the bank is $11 a square foot. So it adds up quickly. And I will say that it adds up quickly. It's $11 a square foot.
Square foot or linear foot?
It's a square foot. And we're
square foot of bank?
Yes.
Yeah.
It's in
how can you have a square foot of bank?
I thought a bank was a linear
bank
foot.
Bank area.
It could go like this, and then you would have a square foot.
Yeah, it says square foot.
How far back? I'm pretty sure it's linear feet. It's a typo. It shouldn't be square feet. It's linear feet.
It is what it is. I don't know.
Well, thank God we haven't collected it from anybody.
I mean,
given them back the money.
How do you calculate square feet? How wide is it?
That's you came up with.
John came up with some numbers, and I was able to do it.
Feet.
I mean,
it's supposed to be linear feet.
Yeah.
Yeah, who wrote these?
But it's in there as square feet, right? So,
actually,
do you have any other advice on my talk with John? No, I haven't. And I sent Dennis an email because, you know, first off, they felt like, wow, what a waste of time this was. We've been here twice already, and we still haven't solved this. And you know, in my opinion.
I feel the same
opinion,
way when they come to us with half-baked plans.
In my opinion, and I was trying to be, defend the commission, which I really didn't have to do. There was no tough questions, but you know, John Dick. So he was saying that he brought it to us a couple of times, and the commission, you know, this is just simple work on a stormwater detention area, and it shouldn't be fees, and it should be an RDA, and they brought it to us twice, and at the end they say no.
Did he bring us an RDA?
He did, twice.
Yes. They
yeah.
did for this maintenance, this cutting down the willows or the
poplar. So I laid out
poplar.
Why it should be a notice of intent, which we talked about, and the fees were secondary. But it was brought up at the meeting from the Danis property that they thought that we denied the RDA because of, first off, fees. And then secondly, the fact that we wanted a notice of intent. So, you know, there was a little bit of correcting going on. But I think we're all moving forward. And, you know, anybody who's offering a product out there, even if it's wetland services, has to sell themselves. And John was, you know, putting the best light on his service to them. So,
isn't he supposed to do that here?
Yes.
Yeah.
Well, he had a chance to do it here.
He didn't bring up fees on that.
He stood here and said, just tell me, don't waste my time. I'll file a notice of intent.
I told him that we have a new member call, and his name is Mr. Couliard. And at one of the site walks, I think the only thing you said was file a notice of intent. I think you said it more than five times. You know?
But
do you remember
John wasn't
that day?
There.
Yeah,
but I think he had
Jamie was there. Jamie Shaw was there.
Okay, well.
He had his mind made up. I mean, the truth of the matter is, I mean, I went there today. The water runs from out from under the Osco drugstore all the way over behind Home Depot. It's a stream.
Right.
Yeah.
Well, I don't like him going to the town manager saying
I don't
we're
an independent board.
We're trying to screw him out of filing fees. That's not right.
Well, I didn't even think of that when I started causing a stink, so whatever.
Jamie, do you recall the woman from Dana's property mentioned that I guess they did the work in 2007.
Right, that sounds about right.
But then in 2009, Fran Fink came down and said stop work. And that's when they put up those bounds. And that they were understood that they couldn't work beyond those within those inbound of those bounds, those gray bounds that we saw
that, yeah.
out there. Do you recall that?
I have no recollection.
That's why you get in writing,
right?
Because it seemed like the project was, I'm going to say, perfect. It had New England Environmental monitoring that from 2005.
They did a nice job too.
2005, 6, 7. That thing was beautiful. And then, you know, what happened, and I missed it at the meeting, but Becky was there, and she told me that they said,
yeah.
Fran, just like you just said, Fran Fink came down and said, don't do anything else. You know, Fran Fink's not here, and it seems unlikely she'd sabotage all that great work, to me. But I wasn't there.
Why would they also stop
knows.
The New England Environmental work? I mean, there's a...
Well, there were only three... There were. After, I think, 2000 or a certain time, they only did it for 3 years.
But there's an order of conditions that
well,
says
that's
what they
it.
Must
she
do.
Wouldn't, she wouldn't have the authority to disqualify a condition
that,
or an order
that
of conditions.
Stop,
we never looked into what that maintenance plan was in the order of conditions.
I'm sorry, what?
I don't remember what the maintenance requirements were in that order of conditions. We should
question.
Be able to look
Chuck
that up.
And no, we have it. Chuck sent it out.
What does it say?
It says dredge four times a year. It says
that he's here
it
because
says
of the
mow.
Climate.
It says do all kinds
they're,
of things.
They're
right.
their own worst
that
enemy.
They haven't done.
So.
And
right.
they Silk haven't
fences.
Done it.
Go behind my
I mean,
back
it's a mess. I went over there today. It's the four bays.
Oh, right. And we pointed that out to him. But I mean, woe on them for not doing it, but woe on us for not. For not
well,
being more aggressive.
It's an old order. It didn't have the language that we...
But it's their maintenance plan that they
yeah.
followed. So
yeah.
I think...
They should have followed it, and we should have made them follow it.
Unreasonable, and they can't follow it. I mean, all those orders.
No, they should have followed. I agree, they should have followed.
Each person that's worked here, there's orders back to the first person that was ever the administrator that you can see. Like, if you look back, you look at some of their language, you go, oh my God, I can, you know, each one of us use something from the old order.
Yeah.
It's a good order, and it's written well.
Yeah.
I just don't know what's happened. But you know what? We could have spent a lot of time on that, and it didn't really matter because they want to move forward, and so do we. It doesn't make any sense to figure out what happened, but here we are.
Well, why do they get a break for being negligent?
Well, they get a break because we consistently do this for anyone, and we're not. It doesn't matter. It doesn't matter who they are. So
remember,
here are the fees, and here are the fees. If anyone says wipe that off the table now, that's great. I would love it. So we have an initial jump into the ring fee of $1,000. That's what it costs to get into the game. So each application has an entry point, and this entry point says each commercial and industrial institutional or other non-residential project. That's where it fits the best.
Right.
That's $1,000. Now the next two are boundary line delineations for within the 25-foot and the 35. Sorry, boundary line delineation area. Okay. I think if I could suggest that two things should happen. First off, Hancock shouldn't hang flags, saving this applicant money, and we don't need to verify them because we know the site.
Right.
So that can be wiped off.
And where the wetlands are, it doesn't matter what they have to do to maintain that facility.
Does anyone consider
Hancock doesn't seem to agree with us where the wetlands are. But it right?
But
I don't think they disagree. I didn't hear them disagree.
But they're not, you know what they're doing? They're not building a house there, so it doesn't really, and they're not putting in a structure.
Mm-hmm.
So, I mean, the only thing that they got to fix that area at the end, but I guess that must be on a plan somewhere. So that's out. And the next one is floodplain. Floodplain goes right up into that moat area where the detention for the stormwater.
Where it comes off the road.
Yeah, it comes off the road and the storm drains.
Yep.
That's on Stop and Shop's property, though.
It's that low point as you drive in. That's been mowed a lot.
It's between where they want to remove the trees and the road for.
Oh, okay.
Grass.
All right.
It's all grass.
Okay.
So, and then John said that you know, when he looks at the flood level, it was like 84. And
84.
And the elevation there is higher, so that's not flood anyway. So we can accept his argument or say we can do two things with this one. His argument's acceptable that he's above the flood level, or there's really no work going on in there. They're not talking about doing anything in that moat area, and it really is just that moat area. So I'm going to say that's out. It sounds like there's consensus there, and he'll talk all this over again at the meeting. And then the last one is bank.
Which
and
is
bank is $11.
Oh, wait a minute. I've missed two. So bank, it says, Jamie was right. It says $11 per linear foot.
Yes.
I said it first.
So how did he come up with so much money? It's only 130 feet
long. I said
it
more strongly.
He did.
So we'll keep that. Have to, because he's doing the most work in the bank.
Right.
Well, and this is what I recall from when they came before us last time. And I didn't think that was an actual application. I thought he came to us, they came to us separately without an application just to meet and said.
He did, but he had the fee calculated. He had a spreadsheet with what the fee would be. And it was, $50,000 or some large number.
Yeah, but remember, a lot of that work was within the wetland.
Right, right.
Cutting limbs.
Right.
Across the street.
Across the street, exactly.
Yes.
I guess
across the driveway, yeah.
In the forested area.
I guess my question is, we made a decision on a reduced price back then. Why can't he hold that still valid now?
The work is totally different.
It's quite a bit different.
Totally different. Different location, different type work. He was going to break that levee along the stream bank to allow flooding. He was going to do a lot of, it was totally different.
Yeah, that was a lot of work.
And we didn't actually approve it. We had...
There was a lot
come
of discussion.
In, come in, yeah, okay.
He came into us in advance to see what might be negotiable.
So it's 130 feet. It's 130 feet...
on either side.
Times two. And it comes to $2,300 at 11. This is a nice computer. Is that too much?
Are you sure we multiply it by two?
Let me,
well,
each side.
I know, but there's always two banks.
No, not always. Sometimes property's on one side, and sometimes there's a different property on the other.
Yeah, but he's still within X number of feet.
If it were a concrete thing and you weren't doing anything, okay, if it, that would be considered bank, but if you're not doing anything on the concrete, you wouldn't consider it. In this instance, you're cutting on either bank.
Both sides also.
Yeah, if you're cutting on both sides, then yeah, take
yes.
both
well,
sides.
Are.
Yeah, okay, all right,
so
I'm with you. I'm with you.
So that's $2,860 for that.
For the bank.
Yeah, so let's just leave it there and then just get the final numbers and then talk about it. And then there's temporary or permanent alteration on land within the buffer zone at 25 feet and at the additional 10 feet, the 35-foot line. And that is, it's like, I just thought there was a caveat there, but there's not. $1.25 per linear foot of resource area. Nope.
That one's square foot.
No, one,
that
square,
one
that's square foot, sorry. Yeah, and it's just 3 cents. So I think the 3 cent one. I calculated this out, and I think it was like 2,399 feet times 1.25. You know, so $2,900 and the other one's $40. So that's another $2,000. But I would make the argument that the work they're doing and. You know, I'm getting this from Jamie, and I agree too that it's kind of like maintenance. And
but it's also removal.
If he'd done the maintenance, he wouldn't have to pay any of this.
Of invasive species, your poplars, your multiflora rose.
But we're going to make sure that they don't do that, or they have to replace that with something. So that can happen in the discussion. You can say, how many native trees are you taking out? If you want to take them all, that's a separate thing. Okay. So they'll have to...
No, I was talking about invasive species. The poplars are invasive. The multiflora rose is a shrub that's invasive. They're taking that stuff out. I thought they were going to keep the native red maple that we saw.
He said they were.
Yeah.
All right, so
we haven't seen it in writing, but he said they were.
He said they were, but I've heard...
Jamie Shaw wanted to remove them.
Yeah.
So for work within 25 feet and 35
all
feet...
All part of not understanding the plan.
It's poplars and red maples? What are we talking about here?
No. Poplars were the invasive. Multiflora rose were the invasive.
Why are we spending so... Let them file an application.
No,
the
we got to... Because I want to talk...
No,
because everyone seems interested
are what
right
they
here.
Are. What they calculate to, like we do with everybody else.
So... For the type of work they're doing, which is kind of maintenance, kind of corrective maintenance, are we going to charge them this work within 25 foot and 35 foot, or should it be on a sliding scale? Tell them to, here's the number, tell us how you think it should be reduced.
I'm good with that.
Okay.
If he can be concise. But for example, that spillway, I believe, spillway, culvert, whatever you want to call it, it needs to be repaired. I think that's a repair. I don't think they should have to pay for that.
Yeah, I would agree. Right. But a poplar, removing poplars, I mean, is that considered part of the square footage that we're calculating?
Well, if a poplar is considered invasive, I'm used to Norway maples being invasive, and then no one's ever said poplar before. But if it's an invasive, we typically don't charge for that.
Yeah, I went online and looked at because I was questioning that.
So this is still $6,000 with what we just did.
So
that's
the total
more than the cost of what they're doing, other than the
say that again, Chuck. The total right now.
The total's around six. I'm not. It's not accurate, but it's 6,000. Maybe it's 6,500. You know.
to do the work. A couple days of a landscaping
Why?
Company.
It's $1,000 to get in the gate.
Yeah.
It's $3,000 for the work within the 25-foot and the 35-foot. And it's $2,800 for the work on the bank, both sides.
What are they doing on the bank? Just removing vegetation?
They're just really removing the vegetation. They're not going to take out the roots. They're chopping it. But they also have to remove the silt fence. And I don't know if that's work, but it's silt fence. And they have to take all the sediment out off the spillway and redo that spillway.
Yeah.
The rip
route. I don't think they should have to pay for that because it's maintenance.
So we're
no.
So it sounds like
spillway.
We just had the discussion that the spillway
is an involved thing.
Well, it sounds like you guys are more apt to agreeing to not charging them for work on the bank, but maybe that work in the 25-foot and the 35-foot area.
Yes.
What are they doing on the bank? Taking out vegetation?
Right. So I'm saying take that out because you're saying I don't get why they have to pay it. Yeah, they're going to cut down all the trees on the bank, but they won't be pulling out the roots.
I still think, I mean, that's a big muddy mess in there. I think when they're in there stomping around with the chainsaw, cutting all that stuff down.
Well, this isn't going to change the controls that we have over it. It's just, is it considered, you know, are we going to make them?
Is it considered maintenance?
Are we going to make them pay the full fee as if somebody else who is actually altering that area?
So we're at $6,000, and then he can come to the commission at that point.
Yeah,
how's that?
I think that's fair because I think if he was,
I mean, I don't want to just
if maintenance was going on with the weed whacker once
I mean,
a year,
would he have to pay then?
Well, that's what
no,
that
would
be
the main
part of the order.
Suppose he gets a big weed whacker that can take out that those bobblers.
Yeah, well, that's what he should do. He needs to mow it once a year.
Right.
But so, you know, I think this is still the discussion is, you know, we're at this point because there was no maintenance over a long period of time. We don't want that to continue. We don't want to see them back in here asking this again in 7 years.
Well, we don't want to go out there and see a big mess.
Or see a big mess and have this, you know, I mean.
All right, so
should we ask for a bond?
We're all set. You guys get the gist of it.
Yeah. Yeah.
And
yeah.
We got down to a number and you can all think about it. And I'm just going to leave you with one more thing. They paid for all this work already with that first order of conditions. It's the exact same work we're going to charge them for again. Some people will see this as paying twice for the same work.
Wait a minute, did they file?
Back in 2004.
Oh, right, yeah, okay, all right.
Yeah, that's what I mean. Yeah. Some people will see this as charging them twice for the same work.
Since 2004, they wouldn't be paying this again, they wouldn't
right.
be back
well,
here.
Yes,
you know,
and that's what I'm getting
this
at.
This wouldn't be an issue.
I'm just giving you the prep work.
I mean, you can't.
You want me to do my John impression? You can unload on me. I'll tell you.
No,
my
no, I don't
want to
unload on anybody. I just don't. I
it's not
I don't
southern.
Even
oh,
know
he's
what
not
the
southern?
Conversation
oh,
is
he,
about.
Oh, is he a Yankee or something? I don't know where he's from.
Yeah, he's from around here. He's
German.
Okay.
Yes.
Do you have any comments, any questions?
Tony DeRosso, 130 John Street. I was going over to Mark Basket the other day, I believe it was after your site visit, and I noticed a few pink flags. I didn't know if those were the trees that were being cut down or the trees that are staying.
Potentially staying. The shrubs and trees that might be staying, but that...
We're not sure yet.
But yes, the
applicant puts the flags on.
Prior to our last site visit, he tried to put flags on trees that he indicated he was going to keep. But since that time, we've kind of gone through this process of, you know, he may be changing what's coming in. On
his notice of intent, if not in the first submittal, in supplemental submittals, will have a plan showing which trees he's keeping, which trees he's taking, and they'll be marked in the field.
Yeah.
Okay, so basically nothing's going to happen until the plan is developed, and then basically every tree that you will either be marked to be cut down or marked to be saved.
Yeah, one or the other, not both.
Correct. But if it's marked to be saved, then the other thing will be cut down.
Right.
Correct.
Okay, that's all.
Thank you. Okay, are we moving on to 13 Harvest Road? Anika, you had a site visit?
I yep
I went to 13 Harvest Road on Sunday. I sent a photo of the area between the house and the river there, and it looked fine to me. I didn't see any erosion issues. I didn't see any dumped waste piles, branches, leaves. It looked good. I didn't see any objection to issuing a certificate of compliance.
So yeah, I got a call from the attorney that represents the owner of the property, and he said that they want to sell, and that there's an old order of condition on the site because a tank, an underground storage tank, needed to be removed. They contracted with Commonwealth Tank to do this work, who actually was the applicant for the notice of intent, and during the process, which they got the tank out, they regraded the lawn, they threw out seed, they removed a tree, and they got their RAO, is that what it is?
Yep.
They got their RAO. What they never did before they went bankrupt or defunct, or I don't know what happened, but they're no longer in existence, is they didn't get a certificate of compliance. So after reviewing the site, this commission typically doesn't request a as-built plan in some situations. There's no as-built plan with this application, but there is a letter from the surveyor saying that he believes everything in the order of condition was taken care of. And when I first went out there, I read the order of conditions, and I noticed that we were talking about two things from that order, that there was a chain link fence on town land, and there was a lot of trash along that stretch of the stream. So I asked, the fence had been removed already. The grass looked fine. It was level and completely vegetated. And all the debris, all the yard waste that was piled up from like 200 feet from one end to the other, the lawyer had a landscaping crew come up here and remove. Mm-hmm. So it was really a nice job.
What year was the original order?
2005, okay.
It's attached, I think.
Yes, it is. So I really think this is a done deal. I move we issue a certificate of compliance.
Is there a second?
Yes,
second.
2005.
All those in favor? Abstain?
Yep.
Yeah, we have this.
Cedar Swamp, northeast boundary of Reading. Did you call them to get anything?
I did. I did call them, and I didn't get a return phone call. So don't feel obligated to
do a site visit.
No,
to
I was asked some questions, and so for a narrative to understand the project, and for maybe the applicant to show up, because it was so long ago, we don't even understand this. This is kind of a big project back in the day, and no one really understood what was happening. This is what I got feedback from chair and vice chair. I made the phone call, didn't get a return call for a long time, and then I think I got one yesterday. And we were never able to connect again. So, yeah.
Quick question. I read the materials. They installed power poles 40 years ago or something. So what are we missing?
They
want a certificate of compliance.
So they want the same thing. They would need a certificate of compliance.
To say it's done, and it was done according to the order of conditions.
Because
they just never finished their paperwork.
Because they probably just have an easement. It's not their deed.
So Anika volunteer to walk.
But I'm not gonna walk it without a plan, that's for sure.
That was one of the things that I requested, was a plan.
One of the things I did see in the order, that there was a provision that they could walk and put some things in the wetland area, but they couldn't
leave. Mats?
No, the mats. I think they should have had those removed. So if those were still there, I mean, we would say something about it. And
you know, when you do walk out there, all those poles have numbers, so you can kind of, you know, give them a general, even if you don't have a plan, oftentimes you can figure out. But if you had a, they should have a plan of their pole numbers.
I was thinking, you know, a plan will at least, if I do see, I know anyone's welcome, of course, to go out and join me, you know, whenever, for the, whenever a plan
when
comes in. Whenever a plan, probably not. Probably not. No, no, I won't be around. But, you know, one of the, I would just be looking, if I were going out, I would just be looking for gross debris.
Might not find it.
I don't expect to find anything, but I think not walking it would.
Right, but if there's a half buried excavator or something.
Well, that's it. If there's something really crazy going on out there, I think we should at least walk it.
I don't think it's a bad idea.
I think it's a great idea for Anika to walk it.
I think you should join me.
Well, I've been canoeing out there, believe it or not.
It's almost a mile.
It's wow. Really hard to get over all the beaver dams.
One way.
But it's fun.
But at least if there's a plan, a map or a plan, I could, if there is anything out there that's suspicious, I could at least mark it
correct
on the plan.
Yeah.
And
know where to go.
To go out there.
Where do you know where to go?
Right.
So I don't know what I would walk without a plan. So.
Right. So.
Just walk down from one pole.
Yeah.
Walk one
pole.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Mariano Drive, that's shared. And do we have an update on the tree policy working group?
We have not met. We're supposed to meet Friday. And it's going to be our first attempt to draft something.
We are meeting
at REI in the common room in the back of the store.
Yep.
Well, town hall's closed on Friday, so we can't meet at town hall. The library doesn't have meeting rooms. I guess I could have gone to the police station. I know they have a meeting room over there, or the Pleasant Street Center.
What about
Matera?
We're talking about Matera.
A place that's already equipped with public access.
Well, there's a few more people.
You know, handicap access and, you know, a public area. It does. It does. But there was a suggestion at the last meeting that it not be isolated.
That's fine. I'm just wondering.
Centrally located. I mean, we don't have to.
Nope,
there was fine. There's no charge for using that room. It's from 11 to 12 on Friday, and the room has capacity for 30.
And it's been noticed, right, Jack?
It's been
posted.
Noticed.
It.
You said
I didn't check on it. No.
What?
I'm going to have to check.
Yeah,
you might
be
postponing this meeting.
It didn't get posted?
I didn't post it.
Oh.
So what about Saturday? You can still do Saturday. Are you two available?
Can't do Saturday.
I can't.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Do Saturday?
I'm around,
so I could draft
something. So I mean,
meeting of one?
We don't know if it's available on Saturday.
Right.
Can I ask a question on this? Is there a policy that you guys are starting with? Do we have something that someone
Chuck
else has done?
Chuck has emailed me a starting place.
Some examples, right?
Some examples. Anybody can come and bring whatever. They can do their own research and bring whatever they think would be suitable. I encourage that.
So
we're not going to Friday? Oh, yeah.
Too late to go Friday.
Too late. It didn't
yeah.
get posted.
If it
it's
didn't
an,
get posted.
It's
going
to be posted.
I got a.
Okay, so.
I
guess it's
not
Friday.
On that one.
So I don't know when we're meeting. Probably someday next week.
Yeah, Al, you're around, right?
I'm around, yeah. So I'm probably the most flexible.
Is Bob Keating aware?
He'll come in later.
Okay.
Once they have a policy, a draft policy.
Oh, after the draft. Okay, I'm sorry.
Okay, so we'll just send out, we'll just communicate. And
give me two dates or one date, whatever. Give me what you got.
Home and look at my calendar.
And you'll send the time and place the meeting and email
to
all the
commissioners?
To
everybody. Absolutely.
Yeah, you might do the Matera cabin. You could do town hall too, and
yeah.
I guess Matera works. I said that, and then REI, yeah.
I haven't been in there. I have a quick different question off topic. Does Matera cabin have furniture?
Yes.
No, we're willing to look at what you have and upgrade.
Okay.
I think you talked to me about that before, but yeah.
I got a couple desk credenza.
I don't know if we need a desk
table,
or a credenza.
Chairs, filing cabinets.
Go in there and look. It's not overly furnished, but it's.
Yeah, it might be something.
Maybe decent stuff, you know, like mahogany.
Well, look at it. No one's offering furniture. You know, no one else is offering furniture. Let's take a look and see if it works somewhere.
Okay.
All right? That's great.
Speaking of, while we're on the topic of Matera, Public Works usually sends out, you know, their seasonal newsletter. And in the past, we've talked about trying to get some, be proactive about it, some information about not dumping and, you know, using our compost facility and not dumping. You know, do we see that as an opportunity to get some information on that and information on Matera Cabin into, is there a way we could partner with that newsletter? Just because those...
As a
those,
town notice that
yeah.
goes out sort of like the town
well, so what
information?
The, well, the...
Newsletters?
Yeah. So what goes out on that is, you know, when
right.
the leaf pickup is,
right.
when the dates are, recycling,
and,
special,
yeah, when the
and then special
compost
dates.
Center is open.
Yep.
With if they're flushing water mains, things like that.
Yeah,
that's a good idea.
So you just try to get people aware that they can use it?
Yeah. So just so we, you know, we're trying to take a little bit more proactive approach on illegal dumping in the wetlands. And
is that, is that related to Matera Cabin? Or
well, and so then I thought, well, can we also get the word out there for Matera Cabin in the same,
okay.
and, you know, where else, like right now, where does it advertise that you can use that? That's a public place to be used.
It's just through recreation right now.
Yeah.
And I'm not
actually,
sure how
you
much.
Know that
I think the Chronicle, don't they?
Is it?
I've seen it.
Oh.
Does anybody get these Maureen Knight?
Yeah.
I do.
Yes,
weekly
I do.
Updates? That
That's
might,
what he's talking
that
about.
That might be. Oh, this is what you're talking about?
I was
in DPW.
No, I wasn't actually thinking that. I was. There's a flyer that actually goes out. I actually don't get that. So
oh,
I don't
is that the one that has
oh.
that yellow thing?
Yeah, the
tells,
yellow
is,
yes.
tells you
when water
the
and
compost
soil.
Is open.
Yeah, what tells you
yeah.
when the compost is open, when
it's
special recycling events are, when...
Right.
And so I mean, that seems like a perfect place to add some...
Please don't dump in
the... Yes, in the wetland.
Yeah. Could come up with a couple blurbs, I think. A couple paragraphs or something.
And
wow.
then
I'm just waiting to which one of you, since I had so much luck with the annual report, which one of you guys going to write
I
this?
Don't mind doing that. If I know we can, if you know,
it's
I can.
It's probably already been
team.
Done. Just need to dig it out and send it out.
No, it hasn't
no.
been done.
No one's ever said we bought this great or we, benefactors of this great.
Yeah, we had open
it's
hands.
It's been in recreation. It's been in recreation.
Someone's already done this.
It's been in recreation's
newsletter, right?
Newsletter.
But having
their
the pictures of it would
volunteer.
Be nice, for example.
They have some in there.
Well, Matera, there's pictures and a whole write-up in the recreation newsletter.
Yeah.
It, they're just old and it's kind of outdated. And, you know, we've been making small changes as we've noticed things. But it would be great to have someone take some really good pictures. We don't have any good pictures. So if anyone is...
I would be happy to take the pictures.
All right.
I've got a nice camera.
Let's get
I've never been inside.
We want to see.
Yeah, we should get inside pictures too.
Oh, just
we used to know the code to get in, but I don't remember what it is.
Do you know how to get how
1, 2, 3, 4
Let's.
No.
How about we?
I
will we not discuss
no,
this?
I know.
It used to be the street address.
I can walk
just
there.
Just send me an email. Yeah.
I assume we don't have any minor projects.
No.
So we have, what about the bills?
What is this other bill?
Oh, ProCops.
What do you mean other bill?
Well, this bill, well, the main bill. I don't care about the $13 one.
It's the Randolph Road, third party.
Randolph Road. Consultant fee.
So I understand. So could you explain What's the minus 600 balance adjustment? What's the...
Goodwill.
So he put in an estimate for the total minus the 600. So something around 2,900 or 800, whatever it was.
$2,873.75.
Yeah. But he's saying he ran over by 600 bucks on all the work he did. Mm-hmm. But he's not charging.
He just wants to let us know.
He just wants to let you know.
Okay.
Is that $2,873.75 consistent with his proposal?
Yes, I checked.
And is that $125 an hour consistent with his proposal? I thought it was less, but I'm going by memory.
No, I didn't check the dollar amount, but I can.
We need to do that.
Okay.
And the other thing is that he did a fair amount of work that was outside of the scope. All that soils work was outside of the scope. Not the soils on site, but the mapping of the soils from other sources. I'm...
Well,
uncomfortable.
Yes, we have it right here. Chuck.
Chuck asked him to do
that. Did you ask him to do that?
To do what?
Just
I didn't hear
to
you.
To do the soils work?
To map the soils.
No.
No, I didn't think so. He did. He took that in
that was
upon
part of
himself, and I think he also did that PowerPoint. We never asked for a PowerPoint
for that either.
Well,
he's not going over his estimate.
But his proposal was that he might come in over his estimate, that it might take less time. It wasn't a lump sum. It was to be on an hourly charge. And that was one reason that I thought that his proposal was superior to the others.
So there's no way to determine, basically, if he's charging us the right amount, is what you're saying.
Well, I'm not saying...
You want to confirm the hourly rate and the scope of work.
If I was the applicant who's paying for this, and these hours represent time he spent doing things that weren't in the scope, I would be concerned.
Well, if the applicant's not concerned.
Well, the applicant hasn't seen this.
No.
But he came in slightly under the total
original. Do you have his proposal there?
Well, I have Mike's... summary?
Spreadsheet.
His spreadsheet. And his total by the spreadsheet was $28,875.50. That's what Mike had. So he's come in on budget.
How much was it?
$28,875.50. So with that balance adjustment at the bottom, he stayed within his budget. And if he did it, so if that $600, let's say, is only time spent, right? So 600 divided by 125 is...
Four or five hours,
and that could be the PowerPoint, and that could be the
presentation was
work.
3 hours, $375.
So, I mean, I'm fine with this invoice.
I apologize, Anika. What was the total that he gave us?
7,375.
That was in his proposal.
No, that's his invoice.
What was in his proposal?
$28,875, right?
So really, the question is, if he didn't do that work, would that $600 come off that $28,750? Should that be 21? Should he come in $600 under?
No.
No.
So then you take it off the $3,400.
Yeah.
If he did out of scope work that we didn't ask for, and we wanted to say, well, we didn't ask for that, you just charge more hours on that, we could take those out, but I see 3 hours for presentation preparation. If that's something we disagreed on, that's $375. So that's less than the $600 he's already taken off. So that's less than the $600 he's already eaten.
I get you. I think I'm with Anika.
As long as that hourly rate is what it was in his proposal, I'm fine with it.
So it
is.
The 125 is what was in my.
You have his proposal.
It was
yep.
in my spreadsheet as well.
Yep. So I mean, I think the only thing we could potentially contest would be something that we know he did not do in the scope of work.
How could we contest that?
Right. And so at this point, I'm ready to approve that.
I think he did what we wanted and above.
Yeah,
it was a helpful job that he did.
Yeah. I think it's appreciated, and I think that's part of him showing the extras, not just say, look, I spent some extra time to make sure that this got was performed to the the residents and our needs.
Now, do we pay this and bill the applicant, or do we just pass this to the applicant?
Just pass it on to the applicant. We didn't.
No, no, no. We already have the money. I submit this. He's a vendor now with the town, so he'll submit
he's
an invoice.
To
this
us.
Invoice, you've approved it. I'll send the minutes upstairs.
So we've already got a check for the applicant from for $2,008.
We have a check from the applicant for
$87.50.
We have a check from the applicant for somewhere between $3,200 and $3,400. I can't remember the exact amount.
So we will return to them the difference between that and $2,873.75.
The check. So this whole process starts by setting up an account, and Mark Hall deposited his check into that account, and now we're going to submit an invoice against that deposit.
And it stays his account?
No, he'll get it. Will there, if we're done, he gets the money back.
Okay.
Probably.
Okay.
Do you see a reason? Does anyone see a reason to keep the difference?
No.
No, we can't.
No. So I'll have two checks cut, one to send back to Mark Hall, and the other one to Bob Prokop.
I think, as I would suggest, as a courtesy, but we'll be interested what the other commissioners say, is as a courtesy, we show this invoice to the applicant.
Yeah, of course. I'll send his check and
he's get the
invoice
difference
to Mark.
He's going
to
see.
Yeah, he's going to see that.
So I move we approve the bill.
Second.
Those in favor? Okay. What else do we have?
Do we need to approve the other bill? Sorry.
Yeah.
Sewer, $13.14.
I move to approve the sewer and water.
Very bold.
A second.
Those in favor? Okay. Meeting minutes. Did anybody review the last meeting minutes?
Can I go to my office and print something out? We need to sign the general way permit, and somehow I got half of it and not the whole thing. We denied that project. So that needs to be signed.
Sure.
Yeah.
Can you get that?
Yeah.
I think I sent.
You did?
Yes, you did.
I looked at it.
I had no changes.
I think when Chuck comes back, we should have him explain why he set us up for this. What the heck was that?
Just making sure we're doing our job, I guess.
That was painful.
I like his dogs, though.
It was helpful for me.
It was? Helped you with do what?
He got a chance to speak.
He helps me understand what the developable area is on that property.
Interesting.
I
think
had put it
I
on
already
her.
Put it on my map. Right. Oh, yeah. I have a big Nikon digital 35mm.
While we're waiting for Chuck.
Put it on your,
oh, really?
I grabbed
lens
the your community
your
connection, which can't. Who is it? Anyway, it comes from Town Hall. And Earth Day is at. Sponsored by the Reading Climate Advisory Committees at RMLD on Saturday the 23rd. We have been a part of Earth Day previously, and Earth Day has been held at Matara Cabin, but it looks like it's got a new permanent place at RMLD. And last time there was Earth Day, the Reading Climate Committee basically said, you know, I know conservation's been part of this in the past, but we're really not doing, we're going into fuel efficiency and energy efficiency and not conservation.
We don't want you anymore.
Yeah. So that's still.
You got trumped.
That's still.
If
so that's going
I was
on.
I was offered by the chair of that committee to participate if CONCOM wanted to. So if we want to, they seem receptive.
Who's the chair?
Ron D'Addario.
I think it might help to have some presence over there.
When is it?
23rd of
Saturday,
some month.
Saturday, April 23rd from 10 a.m. to 2 p.m. Said home presenters are going to be, they're going to talk about solar options, heat pumps, geothermal.
We could get Will Skirtle.
Oh, please.
Of alternative energy?
Please don't.
We could talk about the geothermal pump that we approved over on...
He's on the climate committee. Ray Porter is on the climate committee.
I'm going to build a solar heater for my pool.
Nice. You could bring that. Also featuring plug-in hybrids, electric vehicles. So it's about energy efficiency right now.
I think they are pretty tooled up. I think they have a pretty sophisticated presentation. If we presented something that was less so...
You mean the turtle?
The turtle.
Try it.
This is a turtle.
Oh, no.
he's famous turtle.
Yeah, he's a good turtle.
He shows up at Tan Days for the last two decades.
Yep. Kids love that. They do. They love it.
Have you seen it?
No.
It's just scratching and scratching to get out of its cage.
Well, according to
Kim,
it,
right
here,
I have a pet tortoise.
It gets no other interesting activity throughout the year, so.
I have a question. I don't understand the riverfront 100-foot, 200-foot. Where is that published?
There's a Riverfront Protection Act. And it's a separate act. I think it's not.
So at 1:30 last night.
It's incorporated in the wetlands.
It is.
Reading
yeah.
the
Riverfront
it was a separate
area.
Section 10, which is 246 pages long, I saw the definition of a river. I read that. I get that. And I think we actually have more options than just looking at the satellite picture. But the 100-foot, 200-foot is bylaws. Right? Not.
No,
it's
I think it's in here.
It's part of the Wetlands Protection Act.
The River Protection Act? I forget what year, but they put in Riverfront.
Riverfront Protection Act, which was, in essence, an amendment to the Wetland Protection
Act. And adding river as a protected resource area and adding different buffer zones. Like the wetlands, the bordering vegetated wetlands has a 100-foot buffer zone
right.
under mass regs.
Yeah.
We have a little bit different under our regs, but the riverfront from the top of the bank, there's an inner riparian zone out 100 feet, and then an outer riparian zone.
So that's here, 1058, section 3, or
A3
or B3 or something.
A1. 1058, riverfront?
Yeah. 10.58 parenthesis 2 3.
So in that inner riparian zone,
yeah,
it's the vegetation that is considered, you know, pretty significant to protecting the interests of the river.
Yeah.
And I know that when I did a project out in the western part of the state, I was in that area with a fiber optic. And they said, well, what are you going to do for replication? And I actually had to plant things, but it was actually in an upland, so I had to put in upland vegetation. Otherwise, the wetland vegetation would have died.
So within 100 feet of a riverbank, is it do not disturb? Is it no build?
Supposedly, you're not supposed to cut mature trees, right, Chuck?
Well, you're not supposed to create any, any area that's currently vegetated. You are not supposed to clear that area and put in any structure or impermeable surface.
So, and why, I don't know if it actually says that, but it does say something like, and you know, it's hard to read regulations, but it certainly says that your project within the 100-foot needs to be an improvement on what's there now. So it's really hard to improve, you know, grass
nothing.
And trees and woods, and then it has some other things in it too, but that's the first 100 feet.
Keeping a line.
So
yeah.
You got to think needs to be an improvement, so you need to run down those things. And I don't know how anyone else does it, but when I read the regulations, think of them like little hurdles,
right?
Like little gates.
Right.
Can I get through that gate?
Right.
Is my in the first 100 feet, is it an improvement? Okay, it is. So now we'll go on to the next step and see what it says. And do you pass that? And then it gives you two options. You have to mitigate, or you have to compensate. I don't know what one part is, but you just go through it like that.
So, and then within 200 feet, what's the...
That's where the action comes.
But we weren't supposed to draw it as a semicircle with us.
The 100 to 200 feet away, there's discretion of what can be allowed and what cannot.
And then there, is there guidance in on what can happen within 100 and 200 feet? That's
it's
there. Okay.
The performance standard.
Okay, so I'll go back and look
for
at
that.
That.
All right.
So anything that sort of restricts...
And our bylaws only say, by the way, a canal counts as a river too.
Right.
That's the only difference between our bylaws and those rules.
So is there order of conditions or a project anyone that's been here a while knows that might be nice to find and send out to the new members of the commission so they can kind of...
The high school.
That
the
has
high
to
school was in the riverfront, because at that time we thought that end of the Arizona was riverfront.
Well, Stop and Shop was too. Right?
Yeah, but what did you do for that inner riparian zone?
What happened was part of the new football field with the AstroTurf was within the 100 feet,
mm-hmm.
and it was X number of square feet. So the town had to find X number of square feet to convert or maintain as vegetation and preserve as vegetation to offset what they were taking in the river zone.
And where did they do that?
They did it in that little area. If you go around Birch Bender Drive going west, and you're going past Castine Field, and you turn around,
yeah.
and then once you cross the culvert, where immediately to your left, you'll see that area of vegetation. That was the town.
So it's an upland area. It's usually unmowed. It should be unmowed. I don't know. Can you mow it once a year? But I get calls on it. Why isn't this place getting mowed?
Right, because
and
kids like to walk through and
Sean,
people.
That way, going that way on Bridge Meadow Drive?
Yep.
Yep.
That little area on the right that they were going to
the
make
left.
A skating park in?
No,
no,
no.
A little
no.
postage stamp.
Oh.
Just as you...
It's probably all
Birch
woody
Meadow,
vegetation now. It's right.
Between Birch Meadow and the houses.
I used to live there in that area. On the left, heading toward Hotchon. Is that what you're talking about?
If you're going down, you go around Birch Meadow Drive, and that becomes John Carver.
Right. It's right where that happens.
And it's right where that happens on your left. It's right
okay,
adjacent to the river.
Okay.
Yeah.
Before you get to Intervale Terrace.
Yeah, it's...
The neighbors want to see that mowed and contained because they think kids walk through there to get to the high school, and they get ticks walking through there.
Yeah, but don't the Coolidge kids also do studies and do experiments?
Probably. I wouldn't know.
You know, it's a double-edged sword, I guess.
Well, thank you for that. I appreciate it.
So that's one example.
But along Walker's Brook, I mean, Longhorn Steakhouse and
yeah.
Bertucci's,
that's
riverfront. That's
the canal, getting into that canal area, isn't it?
Well, what's
that's
a canal?
I was thinking about anything
only canal
on...
canal is behind Goddard School.
Anything
that's
on
it.
Arcadia Ave, kind of keeping it close to home, that rings a bell that you kind of... Those are pretty much developed lots, though.
Yeah.
Yeah, there's...
I mean, the big Inwood. I mean, look at what
but Inwood is Woburn.
Yeah,
been
it's
there a while,
Woburn
too.
Sometimes.
Yeah,
you
don't
know
what they did.
Really want to follow their model.
What?
You wouldn't always want to follow their Conservation Commission model.
Okay.
I mean, we don't know it, but... We don't know it. I'd be tempted to say Walker's Brook Drive.
Yeah.
Stop and Shop, Bertucci's, and Longhorn.
It'd be nice if MACC
what did,
had some really good examples that they kept up.
That was different because they were reclaiming a
cap.
I just hate the idea of reclaiming stuff.
Yeah, but that wasn't
well,
that was that
I think Chuck's looking for one
for
it.
Yeah.
For you guys to look at.
Yeah.
Charles is a good example,
right.
Yeah.
Yeah. So what did they do?
I think he's got the same.
The whole thing was
somewhere applicable,
restoration, basically.
There wasn't a whole lot there.
So they claimed it as limited project, which is landfill closure as a limited project.
What were the fees on that? Were the fees reduced?
Oh.
Well, that's a difficult question because... They paid the town $26 million
mm-hmm.
for that property, plus they capped the landfill, which was probably another
ten at least. Yeah.
So what's the fee?
So it was presented as part of the the way that it was structured was that it was closure of a landfill, which has a different action than building a Home Depot. So they were closing the landfill, and they just happened to do it with a Home Depot. But they did pay substantial fees, but it was not calculated.
So they didn't pay any fees to the commission?
Oh, yeah, they did, but not the astronomical fees that would have entailed. Because they rerouted the whole damn river, they replaced the bank, it was huge.
Can I mention, so the off-ramp right next to Honda Gallery right there, there's erosion control and cut vegetation and bare earth that's been worked. Has anyone else noticed that?
The off-ramp from to
the
128?
The off-ramp 128 to head on to North Ave toward Reading. If you look...
That's in Wakefield, I think.
Is that little strip of...
I think so.
Yeah, because we called on that
sign
that's out there, and that was getting fixed, and that whole area
is
Wakefield.
Okay.
And Wakefield didn't care that they were changing that sign over.
There's actually a little bit of Wakefield on the Reading side of 128, on the north side of 128.
I think that's really smart of Wakefield to do that.
Or Honda.
Put all their signage on Reading side, and they own the land, and make it look like it's our fault.
Okay, can we adjourn?
No, we've got the meeting minutes to approve.
I move we approve the meeting minutes
from... Did anyone look at them?
I did.
March. What was the date? What's the date?
It was last...
March 9th.
March 9th?
Second.
Approve with the corrections that that Mike made.
Did you get those? Mm-hmm. Do I hear a second?
Second.
All those in favor? Anything else on the take off? All right.
We need to sign something.
Did you? It got back to me. Did you sign it?
No, yeah. Did I?
No, did. Yes,
did I sign it?
I gave it to you. You must have.
Did you sign it?
Seven.
I think that.
Meeting adjourned. Thank you, everybody.